is open, and why not? You've got the skyline of downtown Miami in the distance, a great crowd of folks either from the Tampa area or from Bowling Green, Kentucky, and their Hilltoppers will get the football first with Kylan Towner back deep to receive, and he has housed one already. Nakarius Fant is also back deep. Towner, second team All-Conference USA, and Desmond, every time you do a bowl game, everybody says the same thing. Can we start playing already, please?
Yeah, so many days in between their last game and this bowl game, and Willie came into the meeting room last night and said, man, our guy's just ready to hit somebody else. And like my old coach used to say in high school, it's great weather for football, folks.
Short kick. This will be Fant to the 20, and that's it. He is smothered at the 20-yard line by Mozzie Williams, or Khalid McGee, actually, on the stop, number 21. And here is one of the top quarterbacks in the country, back-to-back Conference USA Most Valuable Player, Brandon Doughty from nearby Davie, Florida.
When you look at Brandon Doughty, he's a guy who's not going to woo you with his athletic ability, but he's incredibly accurate, 45 touchdowns on the season. I was just talking to an NFL scout who came here just so he could see Doughty. He said he reminds him of a typical West Coast quarterback, a guy who wants to get the ball out of his hands quick, very smart, and knows how to read defenses.
He is a record holder at WKU, projected as a fourth, maybe fifth round pick. He comes out throwing right away, no surprise, and a pick up at about the 23-yard line by Taywan Taylor. That's his 80th catch on the year, and this is the top passing combo in Conference USA.
And what you need to pay attention to is USF's defense. Derek Nichols sat down on that route. He's going to sit down on a lot of these routes because they understand that Doughty wants to get the ball in his hands very quickly.
And the second favorite receiver is Jared Dangerfield, and he is brought down after a short gain of a yard. So we're looking at third down, and they're going to mark him at the 25. We're going to give him a couple on that one. So third down at about four.
Dave, South Florida's defense very fired up for this game. They call themselves the Bull Sharks, and they want to attack and try to get to Doughty, make him hold the ball, and come off of his first read. So far, he's been able to get his first read, but there's been really, really tight windows.
50% on third downs for the Hilltoppers this season. Doughty has time, throws across the middle. It'll be a first down, a catch made by Taylor. And they will move the chain. So you see, right as you mentioned, as he wants the ball out of his hands, first read, boom.
It's going to be up to South Florida's front four to try to get some pressure on Doughty. Now, it's going to be hard because they're in the shotgun, pistol a lot of times, and he wants to get the ball out as fast as possible. So far, so good for the Hilltoppers offense.
He is 3 for 3, a pump fake here, a little bit of trouble, and down he goes. As that first read was covered, Kevin Bronson, number 99, with a sack, a loss of a yard, and that's the 33rd sack by the Bull Sharks this year.
And that's because Dietrich Nichols, number 3, he sat down on the route, so Doughty had to come up his first option, and he was kind of confused.
And Doughty goes into the backfield on a little flare pattern that is wiped out. It was Nicholas Norris, and he's going to lose 5 on the play. USF smothering that play. James Hamilton, number 90, reading it well. It's going to be third down and long.
Tell you what, Dave, so far, Tom Allen's defense, this Bull Shark defense, is doing exactly what they want to do. They're giving them short throws, but they're making tackles immediately.
They need 13. In the middle of the field, it is just dropped. Very simple. The Taylor took his eyes off the football, and a team over the past 3 years that had scored 24 out of 38 games on their opening drive, it's now 24 out of 39.
And that's something you don't see from Taywan Taylor often, drop passes. I mean, kid has over 1,300 receiving yards on the season, 17 touchdowns. I know he wishes he had that one back.
Not sure he would have had a first down there, but at least it would have been a little bit easier for the punter. Jake Collins, a redshirt freshman, is kicking to Tajay Fullwood, who averages about 12 yards per punt. And USF confident their special teams could have a big day today. Little rugby kick, Fullwood gonna put some hands on it, and he better do something now with it, and he is smothered at around the 16-yard line.
And that's one of the reasons you want to go with that rugby kick, because sometimes, Dave, it takes a funny bounce, and as a returner, it's really hard to gauge it, and sometimes it takes an odd hop, and like that happened right there, the returner couldn't catch it clean, therefore he lost yardage on the return.
So bad field position for Quentin Flowers. And this USF Bulls attack, well, the attack at the head coach is the play caller. You do have two offensive coordinators, Danny Hope and David Reeves. And Marlon Mack, number five, watch him. An outstanding running back, 1,273 yards this season.
You can say that again. Outstanding. He's the playmaker.
Empty look here. Now Mack will shift into the backfield. And he can go anytime he gets the football. He'll get it here. And Mack will get about to the 25-yard line. Quint? Quentin Flowers, sophomore from Miami. 31 touchdowns he is responsible for. 41 explosive plays on the year he is responsible for. And it's Rysheen Bronson. And that, yeah, I think it's going to be third down here. And short it is.
Yeah, South Florida's offense, they want to get the ball snapped quickly within seconds of the ball being placed down. They want to put a lot of pressure on this defense of the Hilltoppers.
And that's going to be ruled an incomplete pass. Incomplete. Chris Barr not able to hang on. So we've had two series. Neither team taking a shot down the field just yet. And we have a USF player shaken up on the field. He can't get a clear look at it.
It's Chris Barr.
It is Barr.
It looks like it's his right arm or right wrist he was holding as he was down there on the ground.
Yeah, you can see that very clearly. They're looking at his right wrist. Barr, a freshman from Jacksonville, had 23 catches coming into this bowl game. And he kind of got fell on. That arm was exposed, and Dejon Brown, number 17 for WKU, fell on him. And so Barr in a little bit of discomfort, and we'll find out if he's going to be able to return or not.
Barr's a guy who's been playing very well for them, too, especially as a true freshman, a guy who they relied on in the slot. So if he's not able to come back, it's going to be interesting to see what they do offensively in his absence for a slot receiver.
Nikarius Fant hovering around the 30-yard line is awaiting the punt from Brent Gordon, who is kicking in place of Matthias Shabadi, who was sent home for violating curfew. And that punt takes the wrong spin for USF. It's going to benefit the Hilltoppers, and they will get great field position as one of the best offenses in the country will start from the 40-yard line. Yeah, it's still a little bit of an issue for South Florida to win.
Well, I think the first thing they need to do is to disrupt Western Kentucky's offense by getting some pressure up the middle. You want Brandon Dowdy to feel that heat. And number two, take him off of his first option immediately. Let him sit back there, pat the ball, and try to find his second and third option while you get some pressure up the middle, and hopefully you get a sack or at least throw him off of his timing.
And a first running play for WKU. It's Anthony Wales. And Wales gets across the 45 to about the 48-yard line. It'll be second down and two after that 8-yard gain. A lot of tacklers in there for the Bulls, including number 91, Eric Lee.
You know, they don't really want to run the ball. You have a quarterback like Brandon Dowdy, whose numbers the last two seasons totaled 9,424 passing yards with 94 touchdowns. You know they want to air it out today.
But Wales, you know what, Des, probably going to get 1,000 yards, though. So they are not just a one-dimensional team, but they do throw most of the time. And this is going to hit big for WKU inside the 30 to Jarrett Dangerfield. He's going to be knocked out of bounds along the Hilltoppers sideline. A beautifully designed play.
No, you're right about that. Like you said, they do want to throw the ball, and he's just a little swing route, a little naked to number 21. And what they like to do, Dave, is they like to set up the run with the pass.
Yeah.
Most teams like to set up the pass with the run, but they're going to set up their running game by passing the ball.
Well, some of these passing teams are sneaky good at the running attack, and I think WKU certainly qualifies as that. And you can see that time that pass deflected to the line of scrimmage by Kevin Bronson has already had an impact in this game. Nikarius Fant had sat down on the route, but the pass was deflected at second and 10.
And if I'm the offensive coordinator right now, or the head coach, Brom, I'm looking at USF secondary, especially those corners out there on the island by themselves, and see if they're susceptible to double moves, because they're sitting on routes early in this game.
pressure coming up the middle, picked up. Dowdy going to throw down the middle of the field, and it's incomplete at around the 5-yard line. Dangerfield at 6'3 went up for it. Incomplete. Third down and 10 coming up. Devin Abraham in coverage.
I tell you what they did. The Hilltoppers picked up the blitz very well on that play. That was a good throw. He should have come down with it. Hit both hands. I know he wish he had that one back, but that's what Dowdy can do. He's going to thread the needle. He's going to give his wide receivers a chance to be heroes today.
USF defense giving up just a little over 21 points per game this season. Top 30 in six different categories in FBS. Dowdy, long throw, and it's made by Dangerfield, but did he get the first down? This is really an interesting spot coming up, and he did not make it. Couple of yards short.
You know, that was a long throw, like you said. It was almost from one hash to the opposite side of the field, but it shows you the strength of Brandon Dowdy's arm. So now, looks like they're going to go ahead and keep the offense on the field.
Yep. There's a lot of players coming on, but the field goal team not making it. 10 of 18 on fourth down. They still have time to get off the play. They bring in DeAndre Ferby. He is a power back. Dowdy. And USF rejects the play. It's dropped. Bronson again with pressure. It was dropped by the tight end, Tim Gorski, who is filling in for Tyler Higbee, the outstanding redshirt senior tight end for the Hilltoppers, who will not play today because of injury, and his absence is felt early on. 0-0 with South Florida holding on. They'll get the ball back when we return. Kevin Bronson and Eric Lee and Zach Bullock and many of the USF front.
You know, USF's front is going to be the key to this game. If they can be as disruptive as they have been so far and get to Dowdy, I think this gives them a really good chance to win this game.
Marlon Mack gets to the edge and one of the top backs in the country and certainly in the American Athletic Conference picks up a first down. Gavin Rocker knocks him out of bounds. That's going to be a 15-yard pickup for Mack, who should get over 1,300 yards for the season in his career. Excuse me, for the season today. Flowers, and don't forget, he is an excellent runner, and he will get across to the 41, 42-yard line, a gain of 5 there for Flowers, and it's interesting, Des, sometimes they don't call a lot of runs for him, unlike a lot of other running quarterbacks.
No, you're right about that. They leave it in his hands, but he has an excellent running back behind him in Marlon Mack. These are the impact players you need to watch today. Rodney Adams, a guy who actually got the most improved player award for USF, and watch linebacker number 10, Nick Holt, leads the team in tackles, and John Morris, number 3 defensive lineman, he's going to be disruptive also.
They send the flow left, ran right with Mack, and Dejon Brown was not terribly fooled. That's no gain on the play. Brings up third down and 5. Of course, Nick Holt Jr., number 10 for WKU, is the son of the very animated Western Kentucky coordinator, Nick Holt Sr.
And that's putting it mildly, very animated. Those defensive coordinators, man,
yes.
They're a different breed.
Yeah. By the way, it's not as if Tom Allen on the other sideline is all that quiet either. They're just a little bit different, but in the end, not much. That's going to be incomplete. Fourth down coming up. De'Ernest Johnson was the intended receiver. So at the 8:15 mark here, neither team able to move the football very much.
Which is surprising to me. I thought we'd have at least one touchdown on the board by now because both teams know how to get into the end zone. But I tell you what, both defenses so far has risen to the occasion.
And I really don't know if somebody is barbecuing or vaping or whatever they're doing with the smoke that occasionally rises into your screen. It's not us.
Hey, it's South Miami, it's South Florida, buddy.
It could be anything.
Exactly.
And a fair catch signal was made there by Fant in the opinion of the official. And remember, they'll take anything pretty much as a fair catch signal. So Fant took off, but instead the ball will be put down at the 17-yard line. Western Kentucky's third possession coming up. We have as the football now, but at the moment, USF, although, you know, let's face it, Western Kentucky could have taken a field goal attempt and chose to go for it on fourth and two from the USF 21 and didn't do it. Here's Anthony Wales. He tries to get to the 20, and that's all he's going to get. Good open field tackle that time for the USF defense as we check in with Quint Kesnick. Quint.
Dave, you made an excellent point earlier about Western Kentucky operating without their star tight end, Tyler Higbee, a senior, projected to be an NFL mid-round pick. 38 receptions, but 8 of those for touchdowns. He's a huge target at third and medium and in the red zone.
Yeah, and they've already had Quint, a tight end, Gorski, drop a pass on that fourth down play. As Dowdy going to take the first deep shot of the game. Taylor, and it's over his head at the 30-yard line. Looks like Taylor had gotten a little bit clear of Dietrich Nichols and Devin Abraham. It'll be third down and 7.
The Hilltoppers used a little play action on that play, Dave, and tried to get Dowdy out away from the coverage because there is penetration up the middle from the Bull Shark defense. And rolled him out. Surprised he missed that one, though, because he had a guy wide open.
Yeah, Taylor definitely had a step.
Yeah, Taylor wide open.
Yep. And this time getting open and not getting a catch made is Antoine Grant. He was open. Yeah. And I don't know if he misjudged the football there, but it's going to be fourth down. It would look like it should have been a first down and a lot more.
It looked like Grant, you know, kept going. He didn't slow down at all. It just seems like I think Dowdy needs to settle down a little bit. You know, I talked to Jeff Brohm yesterday about Dowdy's his last game. He's from the area. Do you think he may press a little bit? And I think that's what we're experiencing so far in this first quarter because Dowdy's one of the most accurate quarterbacks in all of football, not just short throws, but deep throws too.
So Collins kicking to Fullwood. There's that rugby kick. They come out low and hot, and Fullwood's going to make the catch, makes one miss, but not everybody, and they smother him in around the 37-yard line. Want to remind you, tomorrow on ESPN, Capital One Bowl season continues. We've got the famous Idaho Potato Bowl on the blue turf in Boise. Akron versus Utah State at 3:30 Eastern. Then at 7 o'clock, number 24, Temple and Toledo in the Marmo Boca Raton Bowl. And I'll have that one on ESPN Radio, so you have your choice of your favorite ways to listen or watch to a game. It is the most wonderful time of the year. Both games are also streaming live on Watch ESPN. So now it's up to Quentin Flowers. You talk about a local guy. Is he pressing a little bit? He's right from in Miami. Throw a quick screen out here. Caught by Bronson. And Bronson will pick up 7, setting up second down and 3.
And that's what you want to do as an offensive coordinator. You want to get your quarterback into the flow of the game, get a rhythm going, some nice, quick, easy, high percentage throws, just like that one right there for Quentin Flowers.
Have not seen Flowers run that zone read yet. He's not going to here with an empty backfield. He's going to take a shot, and it is incomplete. Just missed. In fact, that was nearly intercepted as he tried once again to get it to Rysheen Bronson. Let's get an update on the injured USF player from earlier, Chris Barr, from Quint.
That Chris Barr, slot receiver for the Bulls, will return to this ball game. They'll miss him, especially his speed. He's their third leading receiver. What I'm seeing down here, Dave, you guys mentioned it, this is bull rust. You know, both these offenses were absolutely clicking the last 3 weeks of the season, and I think the 3 weeks off has really helped benefited the defenses more than these offenses. They're still working off the script on the Bulls sideline. They script their first 11 plays. They call them the Lucky 11.
Not yet. Not so far, anyway. That they may have crapped out on Lucky 11. It's, you know, last three games, Desmond, the USF 51 points a game, and Western Kentucky 52.
Wow.
And we got a penalty there on an illegal receiver downfield. The referee's mic not working.
Oh, okay.
So we're looking at second down and 7. Back to the ground. That's always a good move for USF when you can get it to Marlon Mack. And Mack gets it into Hilltopper territory, brought down at around the 35-yard line by Wonderful Terry, number 5.
South Florida's doing a really good job of just spreading Western Kentucky out and then running a read option. And Marlon Mack is a guy who averages 6.6 yards per carry, and he's very explosive.
Flowers caught at the 15-yard line. There's Rysheen Bronson, the sophomore from the western side of Florida in Fort Myers, a first down for the Bulls at the 13.
I'm going to tell you what, Dave. That's a confidence builder right there for Flowers. To be able to hit that seam route right down the field, a perfect throw, that gets a quarterback like Flowers going.
He wants it, and he wants it right now. Little jet sweep. That's actually a little pass to Rodney Adams. There's a name we haven't called yet. One of your impact players, Rodney Adams. And no gain on the play as the Hilltopper defense smothered that. Second down.
It's still early. It's still early. Rodney's going to make his impact at some point. At least I hope so.
Former player at Toledo who actually came back to West Florida after a tragedy, lost his mom in a car accident, and he came back home and enrolled at USF and has been a great player for them.
Seems like there's a little confusion right now for USF offensively where to line up.
And it's Flowers. This is a design draw. Got a couple of good blocks. Race to the corner. He'll get in easily. Touchdown, USF.
But they figured it out, didn't they? And that's what makes Flowers so dangerous, because once he gets the ball in his hands, he's a very dynamic runner, very good speed, and this is what's going to give Nick Holt's defense fits today.
That was design confusion, Des, I'm sure.
Without a doubt.
And a great block. Tyree McCants, number 8, the receiver, and also Bronson, 81, had a couple of key blocks down the field, too.
Yeah, Bronson is an excellent blocking receiver. The coaches couldn't talk enough about how much they appreciate the way he blocks on the perimeter.
So with Chabadi sent home, you also have a new holder in Brent Gordon. He does a nice job, and we have our first score of the game. USF in front of WKU on a touchdown run by Quentin Flowers. One thing, watch ESPN is now in the ESPN app. With Desmond Howard and Quint Kesnick, I'm Dave Lamont. USF with their 50th offensive touchdown of the season. That is a new school record. And an immediate challenge now for Kylan Towner to get WKU going in the special teams game, and he'll do something across the 35 to the 39, but there's a flag down at the 30-yard line. Our officiating crew from the MAC. Greg Blum is the referee.
Looks like that one's coming back.
Yep. So it's going to be first down, but a nice return there by Towner is going to be wiped out by the holding call. Take a good look at Jeff Brom, the head coach. Played for Howard Stellenberger at Louisville. Actually worked with him as for 1 year as a quarterback coach at Florida Atlantic in 2009. And Jeff, in his second year at WKU, 19-7. And this year, the Hilltoppers becoming the first team ever to win Conference USA by going unbeaten all the way through, including the conference championship game. Furby, to the 23-yard line, picks up a hard-earned 3 yards. He is no fun to tackle.
No, he's a load at 240 pounds. He runs very hard behind his pass. All he knows is north and south. He looks like he's a little nicked up, though. He's coming off the field a little gimpy. They have to keep an eye on him.
Usually he makes other people gimpy. It looks like he should be able to get back into the game. Taylor goes into the backfield as Western Kentucky will get it to him. Just shy of the first down. Augie Sanchez, leading tackler for USF, in there on a stop. Number 43, a redshirt sophomore from St. Pete. Here's a big third down and about a yard to go. He's right back into the game, and that is close.
Very close.
Furby, man, I don't know.
I don't either. This is going to be an interesting spot.
Although now you look at the one official coming in, his feet were right on the 30-yard line. Fourth down.
Wow.
Wow, I thought, and I don't see the punter coming on the field. Now, this could be the draw them offside play, or they could be seriously going for it.
So far, Western Kentucky is 56% on fourth downs on the season. I think they may try to draw him offsides.
Oh, the ball to Furby, he got it easily.
Oh, my. Did you see him hit that linebacker?
That was a big old collision there with Augie Sanchez and DeAndre Furby.
I think Furby's okay. You know, he may have been playing possum earlier when he limped off the field. Whoa. And that's Augie Sanchez, one of their best tacklers, too.
Here comes a reverse. The flea flicker pass. Dowdy wide open, and he missed Taylor. To be honest with you, as badly as you can miss a guy, I'm shocked that pass went awry like it did.
You and I both. And we knew they would do some type of razzle-dazzle early in the game. I guess Jeff Brown, the head coach, felt like this was the time to do it, and Dowdy actually paid a price at the end of this for that pass, too.
A little hand to the face.
A little bit. No flag, though.
Nope. Mike Love, number 98, got a hand up near the face mask, but no flag, as Dez said. Second down and 10. Now a lot of pressure. Middle screen set up. USF read it well, but they can't get Anthony Wales at first. Still running hard as Wales, and he'll fight to the 40-yard line. He'll be a couple of yards shy of the first down after an impressive 6-yard, maybe 7-yard pickup.
A hard run by Anthony Wales. Really good pursuit by USF, but just poor tackling on the play.
I thought they had it well read.
They did. I mean, they read it well, just poor tackling. The technique, the fundamentals, they were lacking on that play. But this is what Western Kentucky can do, too. When they're struggling, things aren't going good for them offensively, they can throw several different screens at you just to slow down that defensive front.
With a pretty basic running play here with Anthony Wales. Sanchez brings him down, but that offensive line, which has some outstanding Conference USA all-first-teamers, and guys like Forrest Lamp, Brandon Ray, and Darrell Williams Jr. making consecutive starts, 36, 27, and 24, respectively, and it's a first down.
With Brandon Dowdy in the shotgun and pistol formation, I think that USF, they were just teeing off up front. So Brom says, you know what, let's go and just run at them, and so our guys can be a little aggressive.
Still inaccurate on the throws, though. Trying to get it to Nicholas Norris that time. It'll be second down and 10.
And we're talking about a lot of down-the-field throws, too. Maybe they need to dial up just some short or intermediate passes just to get Dowdy into some sort of rhythm, get him comfortable, get his confidence going. Because right now, I don't know the last time I've seen this quarterback play this bad as far as his passing game is concerned.
He's 7-15 for only 53 yards right now. He's going to throw pass number 16 here. There's a tunnel screen, and it's going to be out to the 45-yard line, caught by Antoine Grant, a senior from Wilmington, Delaware. And Grant will be a little short of the first down. James Hamilton brought him down, so here comes a big third down and short. But if they get to fourth down, they'll go for it again, I'm sure. Why would you punt now?
Exactly. No, I'm with you. And that's the type of pass that you want to get, you know, Dowdy to throw. A little bubble screen, get the ball into the receiver's hands, let them run with it.
That was career completion number 1,000 for Dowdy. Furby, another collision. He spun off of that. Nigel Harris in there on the stop. And I don't know. Again, he's looking at that line judge coming in. Yeah. If they don't make it, you know what the Hilltoppers are going to do.
Yeah, you know what they're going to do. It's surprising to see them go 22 personnel so much this early in the game.
Coming up to 1 minute in this opening quarter with USF in front, 7-0 over WKU.
WKU going to two tight ends a lot early in the game.
Running downhill is Furby. He gets started like he got a great start that time. He's going to be so hard to stop.
Wow. You said downhill. He's like a Mack truck going downhill. And he's just, what a load at 240. He's coming out the game now. If I'm a defender, I'm like, that's good. It's 32 headed to the sideline. He is punishing defensive linemen and linebackers.
He's hitting them first. Now they go the other way with Wales, and what a great tackle from behind. Kevin Bronson again, number 99, playing a huge first quarter for the Bull Shark defense of Tom Allen.
Bronson's a freshman from Delray Beach, and this guy came in the game versus Temple, and they did not miss a beat.
And that will be the end of the first quarter. The only score so far coming from the feet of Quentin Flowers, the sophomore from South Florida. Grew up not far from Marlins Park. And he has put the only points in the end zone so far. Quarter two coming up on the Miami Beach Bowl. They lead after one quarter, 7-0 in this matchup of the Conference USA champions and representatives of the American Athletic Conference. And a flag comes in. Yeah, got a little false start. I've not had very many penalties in this game. Total yards, 97 for USF and WKU at 90. Get a look at Jeff Brom there in the black hat. He is the play caller. Both head coaches are play callers in this game. Both of them quarterbacks.
Exactly. Yep.
Try telling a quarterback to call a play, and good luck with that.
Yeah.
And WKU goes to more ground and pound. Down to the 40-yard line is Furby. That time, instead of up the gut, he ran off that powerful left side of the WKU line, and Sanat was in there on the stop.
And that's the strength of their line, too, where number 76, Forrest Lamp is, and Brandon Ray, number 51, the right, the left guard. That's the strength. And it just seems like they're content just trying to run the ball a little bit now to try to just offset the aggressiveness of USF's front seven.
On third and 11, the 14th play of the drive, Dowdy, and it's intercepted at the 30-yard line by USF. Nigel Harris comes away with it, and he's knocked around to the 50-yard line. And the first turnover of the game goes to that Bull Shark defense.
Dowdy threw the ball almost 500 times this year, and only 7 interceptions. I mean, that's outstanding when you think about those numbers. And so far in this first half, he doesn't look like the same quarterback at all. That's his 8th pick of the season, and he's just been struggling this whole first half.
If you remember the meetings yesterday, and I know you do, they said, we got to get him to pat the football.
Yeah.
And he did there. There was a clear pat of the football, and then he threw the interception caught by Harris. Now Tice is in the tailback, number 31, for his first appearance of the game. Flowers, shoulder shake, under some pressure, and he is going to get away at the 45, throws it away. Now, there's not a receiver in the area, although one came down pretty late. It was wonderful Terry who had him and could not hang on to him.
Yeah.
And looks like we're not going to get a flag. It'll be second down and 10.
And to go back to Dowdy, I mean, he started this game 4-for-4, but since then, must be 5-for-14 with the pick. They really need to see how they can get him into the Florida offense, get some sort of rhythm with him, because without Dowdy, this offense is going to be stuck in the mud.
Flowers on his own read, and he will take a beautiful run out to the right side, get to about the 36-yard line, little scuffle after the play. Deshaun Brown, number 17, in there on the stop, and that's going to be a chain mover for USF. Flowers runs the zone read extremely well.
Yeah.
And this has been a great quarter for USF as Tice, he got stuffed. There'll be nothing there. Maybe a yard if they want to be generous. Tackle made by the interior of that WKU defense. There's so many in there.
You know, that's the big difference between the two offenses. If Dowdy struggles throwing the ball, you know, this team, I don't know if they have a second option as far as can they really run effectively and win the game.
Yeah,
but
could, yeah.
If Flowers struggles, yeah. Flowers can throw. I mean, so Flowers can run. He can improvise. He can make things happen. So they know their offense still can be in rhythm, even if he can't throw the ball effective early.
And you get an idea about the wind. It was, we were out on the beach area yesterday. It was really breezy. And this stadium, if you know much about the Miami Marlins, it's hard to hit home runs here. And they're talking about moving the fences in to increase the scoring. So the breeze here swirling around that field right now, and it can be very difficult on the kickers. We haven't seen any evidence of it yet, but we might as the game goes on.
They may move the fences in, and don't forget, they got Barry Bonds is going to be their new hitting coach. So
yeah. He'll help him if he can still hit. As Flowers that time trying to ad lib and doesn't get anything. It'll be third down. Gavin Rocker in there on the stop. Third and 14.
It seems like Western Kentucky right now is content with going with the 7 or 8 man front to try to stop the run and say, hey, we're going to make Quentin Flowers throw the ball and beat us with his arm.
De'Ernest Johnson, 32, coming in. So Marlon Mack getting a little bit of a break at the start of the second quarter with the Bulls in front. Johnson checks out of the backfield, and it's a straight run to Flowers. And I tell you what, there's nowhere to go. That time, the Nick Holt coach and Nick Holt-led defense made sure there was no running lanes for Flowers, and there's a flag down. An illegal substitution penalty on the Hilltoppers defense. So instead of fourth down and long, it's going to be third down and 8. And that's not going to make Nick Holt Sr. terribly happy as he signals in his defense.
Yeah, they just let USF off the hook with that penalty.
But you bring up a good point about the comparison of the two quarterbacks, whereas Flowers does have that extra dimension that Doughty doesn't have. And now they go wide with Rodney Adams, and Adams breaks loose down to the 10, and he'll score.
I believe that's my impact player, Rodney Adams, who's also the most improved player on the football team. He's a great blocker out there on the perimeter, but he's really good with the ball in his hands. Willie Taggart, Danny Hope, they all said we need to get the ball to the hands of Rodney Adams, and you see why right here.
USF has outscored their opponents 138-43 in the second quarter this season. And again, you said it right. They gave them another chance. It was going to be fourth and 13 except for the illegal substitution penalty.
Yeah, yeah.
And on third down and 8, the Bulls from the American make them pay. And USF in early command here in the second quarter with 12:18 remaining in the Miami Beach Bowl. It's the Florida-based Bulls in front of the Bowling Green-based Hilltoppers.
Just an incredible athlete.
I guess, just
a sick athlete.
And hopefully you enjoyed the Raycom Camellia Bowl with App State getting the win over Ohio. We got this is the only bowl game today. We got a bunch coming up after that, though. And now the issue here for WKU is they've got to get their quarterback, Brandon Doughty, going. And he's not going to get great field position. But so far, Desmond, one of the best passers in the country, is struggling today.
Yeah, one of the most accurate passers in all FBS football. It's just amazing to see how he struggled so far early, especially with throws down the field. No pressure in his face. He just missed that one. Maybe it should have been caught. But here he is. This is a clear touchdown. He can't hit his wide receiver. Taywan Taylor, and right here, just misses again down the field on Twain Grant. I think he needs some more just short intermediate throws, maybe some bubble screens, hitches, slants. They need to get him into a rhythm. He needs to see the ball being completed right now. Kind of like a jump shooter who needs to see the ball go through the net.
Right now he's being point guard and handing it off to Anthony Wales for a 5-yard pickup. Second down and 5 coming up. And that interception to Harris cost 7 points because USF goes down and scores off of that.
Right.
Just the 8th interception against 45 touchdowns for Doughty.
And you wonder about where is he at mentally right now. Like I said, he's a kid from down here in South Florida. Has a lot of friends and family here. I saw him in the hotel 2 days ago. He talked about the people coming to the game to watch him. This is his last game. So, you know, at this point, you wonder where is he mentally. You know, can he come out of this ditch that he's dug for himself as far as throwing the ball? And now you're looking at the Hilltoppers. They're running the ball a lot. I mean, this is not Hilltopper football.
They do get a first down on a couple of carries by Anthony Wales. They show you the comparison. They've thrown for 211 more yards than they do on average rushing per game. 154.5 on the ground, 365 in the air, number 6 in the country.
And you think about the absence, too, of the tight end, Tyler Higbee. I mean, he's a guy who Coach Brohm said owned the hashes. They're going to miss him. I didn't think they would miss him this much in the passing game, but I don't know. He doesn't throw the ball, and there have been some wide-open receivers that Doughty's just missed. So I mean, it's different when you have a guy like Higbee who can catch intermediate passes, but still, the ball down the field, you got to complete those. Those are home run balls.
Second down and nine after the short gain by Wales. Now a little tunnel screen, and it's going to be caught by Taylor, and he'll get out to the 37-yard line. Jamie Bird, a hard hitter at what they call the Husky position, kind of a nickelback, stops him. So third down after the five-yard gain.
Yeah, Jamie Bird is like a hybrid safety slash corner. Not a big guy, but he packs a heck of a punch when he hits the opponents. And they really love him at that Husky position.
Which is misleading because he's barely 185 pounds.
Yeah, exactly.
Dowdy, big third down here. Flag comes in. Dowdy's going to take off. And he'll be cut down short of the first down. Gut instinct says it's probably a holding penalty. Zach Bullock chasing Dowdy. And let's see what happens if our gut instinct is correct on the call.
I wouldn't doubt it because the offensive line, they're used to Dowdy being right back there in the back and not moving.
Well, sometimes it's oversimplifying, Des, to say, well, it's important the lines play well for your team to win. That's right. Obvious. But
right.
It was really emphasized by both coaching staffs how important the USF defensive line it was going to be to this game. And right now I would say they're winning.
Oh, if I'm Tom Allen, defensive coordinator of the Bull Sharks, I'm really happy right now with the performance of my defense. They're doing exactly what I wanted them to do. They're executing at a high level. They're disruptive. And they're getting Dowdy off of his game, and they're getting him off the mark, too. You know, he's like a sitting duck back there. He's not a very mobile quarterback. He likes to set up back there and pick a defensive part. And they're not allowing him to do that today.
Now, USF kept their defense, their base defense on the field. This is a fabulous punt by Jay Collins out of Louisville. And he will get just to the 4-yard line for its bad field position for Quentin Flowers. But he's got the winning score in his back pocket right now. Was dangling by a thread at one point this year, 1-3.
Yeah, he really was. And it's interesting when you talk to the coaches because they said that he never wavered, though. Like, if he felt any pressure, he never showed it to the staff or the players. He just stayed the course. He believed in his team. And then they bounced back. And I think that one thing that they talked about was the confidence, you know, how much confidence they've gained. And I think Quentin Flowers was the one who really got them going. Once Quentin Flowers, the quarterback, started to play better, and he started to show his type of confidence and his leadership, then not only did the offense follow him, but so did the defense.
The turnaround is one of the best in the country. We have flags down here. Looks like we're headed for a false start penalty against the Bulls. Flowers not a normally a talkative guy, but he is up to that. In fact, he came out of the tunnel today a little with
five.
A little bit of personality.
Yeah. After this is the goal, second down.
So that's going to back up the Bulls. But young man's gone through a lifetime of adversity, tragedies in his life, lost his father, was hit by a stray bullet standing outside their home. His mother was lost to cancer. He lost another family member in an auto accident.
Yeah.
He has had, so this is, I mean, compared to all that, it's a football game. This is fun.
No, you're right about that. And that's why Coach Taggart said he knew that with Flowers at the quarterback position, there's nothing that would shake him, that would rattle him, because he's been through so much adversity through his life off the football field.
And he's leading the block right now and throws a good one for Mack as he gets down the sideline. And Marlon Mack made something out of nothing on that play because the Hilltoppers had shut down the middle of the field. But running behind Flowers, he was able to get a first down after 24 yards.
And that's what you get with Marlon Mack. I mean, he's a guy who's very explosive. He has great vision, but once he sees the edge, he's going to turn the corner, and not many people are going to catch him either.
73 yards on 5 carries for Mack, and out of they go to the ground, and Darius Tice gets it to the 32-yard line. Picks up a couple more. He mentioned the turnaround from Willie Taggart. They started him. This is just his third year. He's 14-22. Two wins in 2013. Now 8. And you see what that in FBS, what that's been like. Also, Western Michigan has had a similar great turnaround from 1 year a couple of years ago to where they're 7 right now. So it's And you saw, you know, at Florida, Jim McElwain, at Michigan with Jim Harbaugh, it can be done.
Oh, no doubt about that.
And not much there in the middle of the defense. Derek Overstreet, the leading tackling lineman for this Nick Holt defense. Not much, maybe a yard. So it comes a big third down and long.
And they expound on Quentin Flowers' journey. You know, through the age, but from the age of 4 to 15, he became a member of the Liberty City Optimist Club, ran by Luther Campbell.
Oh, yeah.
People know him as Uncle Luke from Two Live Crew. And Luke was like a mentor to him, and he was able to play alongside guys like Dalvin Cook, Duke Johnson, Teddy Bridgewater, just to name a few. And he stayed encouraged, and Luke stayed in his life. And Luke is actually here at this game with the 120 players from the Optimist Club.
And that could have been, and I'm sure if you're a WKU fan, feel like it should have been, an interception. Marcus Ward got a hand on it. There were way more Hilltoppers than Bulls around that pass, and it's very fortunate for USF that it wasn't intercepted. It'll be fourth down and eight. So Brent Gordon, again, replacing Matias Chibati, who was sent home. His football career over. He's a grad, and he busted curfew, and that's not going to cut it. Fan awaiting the punt. This got a little wobble to it. Makes a clean fair catch signal at about the 34-yard line. So decent field position for this WKU offense, which has frankly been sputtering, but there's 6:55 to go and a half for them to get it together. It is the most wonderful time of the year. Both games are also streaming live on the ESPN app. I like those matchups.
Oh,
those are good games.
Yes, sir.
Nope, now it's Anthony Wales. Little flea flicker. Downey wide open. Caught 25-yard line. Down to the 15. Taywan Taylor.
And, you know, I tell you what. That was a really good throw, but a better throw, and Taylor walks into the end zone. I mean, he had the defender beat by at least 5 yards. He had to wait on the throw, and that's a throw that Dowdy normally can get to the guy, the receiver, in stride. But that may be the completion that he needs to get on track today.
53-yard pickup puts him in the red zone at the 13-yard line. Little misdirection handoff. This is Wales getting in the end zone. Touchdown, WKU. They're back in it just like that. Two-play drive.
And that's what Wales brings to the offense. Speed, quickness. He's going to turn the edge just like USF's Marlon Mack. And now nobody's pouting on the Western Kentucky sideline anymore, I tell you that.
Well, I'd like to bring Quint in here for a second. They may be taking a closer look at this play to see if he scored. They're going to review it. So, Quint, you were going to tell us one thing, but it appears maybe it now is another.
Yeah, coming out of that change of possession, you just did not like the body language of the Hilltoppers. They're kind of moping, standing around, waiting for a spark. And you got to give Jeff Brohm, their head coach, a lot of credit for calling that trick play. You guys have been pointing to Dowdy as being subpar. I think it's more widespread, but I think the two big plays now can be that spark, this team coming to life.
Now the replay review here, initiated by the communicator Steve Barnes. The replay official is Rick Jackson. The issue here, is this a touchdown or not? Did he cross the plane of the goal line or the pylon with the football? We also have a referee, John Sullivan, with us in the booth to help us interpret. And it'll be interesting. John says it's close.
I agree with John.
Well, remember, the touchdown is the call on the field.
Right.
So is this indisputable video evidence to overturn this?
We need the pylon camera on this one.
Yes, sir. Or GoPro, at least. Somebody run out to the local store and grab a GoPro.
Yeah, if we had a pylon camera, because this angle, you still don't know. At this point, is the tip of the ball over the goal line? Or did it just break the plane of the goal line? Because that's all you need, is the tip to break the plane.
If he had caught the ball, good Lord, we'd be here for 25 minutes trying to explain what a catch is.
Easy, exactly.
After review, the ruling of a touchdown stands.
And I think that's a fair call, because stands so means they don't have the evidence to turn it over.
Exactly, and I agree with that. We need the pylon cam.
Yeah. So the down sideline that Quint was going to tell us about is now turned around, as he mentioned. And WKU very quickly.
Let's go.
And they're good at this. One of the best offenses in the country. 44 points a game. 224 points in the second quarter this year. Most in the country, as you would guess. That's a two-play drive to 38 seconds, 66 yards, and we have a little tighter ball game than we did about 3 or 4 minutes ago at the Miami Beach Bowl at Marlins Park. By the way, WKU now has a school record 585 points this season.
Wow.
Isn't that amazing?
It's incredible.
There are teams that go two seasons without that.
And then they go and do this.
Yeah, this is a snappy out of bounds. So great field position for USF. Yeah, I don't know if your head coaches yell at kickers too often, but he might want to this time. Now, Willie Taggart mentioned that he has
the ball be placed at the 35-yard line. Down.
Hilltopper in his blood. He was a great quarterback for Western Kentucky. Mm-hmm. 1995 to 98. Then he became an assistant coach upon the end of his career, 99 to 2006. He headed west a little bit. It's time to Stanford with Jim Harbaugh. Very close to the Harbaugh family, by the way, Jack, Jim, and John.
Yes,
he became the head coach at WKU in 2010. And then took them to a bowl, did not coach the bowl game. And now he is playing against them today. And there, once again, the defense coming through.
And my brother's keeper, Jim Money Brown, with the penetration and tackle for a loss. Really good job up front, just reading the run, beating his man across his face, getting USF off schedule offensively.
And he was born Jumani Brown, but later on in life said, you know, New Jack City, and I like G-Money. Now, I thought of Glenn Rice, the former Miami Heat player who was G-Money before there was New Jack City, as I remember, if I got my timeline right. Either way, he's legally G-Money Brown.
That's his name.
They have some really interesting names on the defensive side of the ball for the Hilltoppers.
You got Wonderful Terry, the cornerback, number 5.
You got Prince Charles.
And Matt, number 5, just flat fell down.
Cornerback number 30, Prince Charles.
And that is his first name, by the way.
Yeah.
It's not Prince Charles. It's Prince Charles Awara.
Exactly.
So now, third down and 15 as G-Money checks out. And USF being extremely patient. De'Ernest Johnson with back in. 1 out of 4 on third down for Quentin Flowers and USF. He's got a couple of receivers open if he can see them, but he can't. He's going to have to ad lib. Oh, my goodness, he got free. He still has a chance. Couple of people downfield, and he missed. Tyree McCants was the intended receiver. All the way on the other side is the open guy.
Yeah. All I got to say is that just might be one of the most exciting incompletions you will see the whole bowl season. I tell you what, that Quentin Flowers, man, he's slippery. He's like a fish in oil. It can't grab this kid.
It was Sean Price, the tight end, who was just jumping jack, skipping rope, double dutch, whatever he could do to get the quarterback's attention. And Flowers just couldn't see him, understandably. He's running for his life.
Right.
It's a really high punt. And a fair catch made inside the 30-yard line at about the 27. That's 42 yards length and about 42 yards up as well. He got that way into the South Florida breeze. 5:02 remaining in this half. South Florida scored the first 14. Western Kentucky went on a 66-yard drive to cover just 2 plays using a flea flicker, their second trick play of the day. This one worked. The first one did not.
Yep.
And that set up then a touchdown run by Wales.
The Hilltoppers have been going to a 2-tight-end offense a lot in the second quarter, I think because they're using a lot of play action and sucking up the Bull Sharks defense and getting deep behind them.
And they stay on the ground here with Wales. And there is the penetration from that athletic, smart, and talented USF line. A loss of three there. Eric Lee, a second-team All-American Conference. Second and 13.
Just not used to seeing the Hilltoppers run the ball so much offensively. But I guess they want to try to get some sort of push up front just to slow down the Bull Sharks front seven, because they've been teeing off so far on the Hilltoppers offensive line.
Dowdy, little screen pass here. Wales breaks one tackle down to the 35, to the 37, 38. There's a flag down in the middle of the field. Nichols ran him OB. Let's see what the call is.
I see Forrest Lamp talking to the official, pleading his case.
That's never a good sign if you're on the offense. Lamp is a first-teamer, All-Conference USA, making his 36th straight start today. He definitely has NFL potential.
Definitely, yeah. Probably as a guard. He's a left tackle at this level. He'll probably play guard in NFL.
There's no foul for offensive pass interference. The pass was caught behind the neutral zone. Time on the field for measurement.
All right, clock stopped at 4:24. We'll find out whether or not that is going to be a first down. Good communication by the officiating crew from the Mid-American Conference. They're just thrilled they're not in one of those chilly November games that happened during Maction, where you better get your long sleeves out.
Oh, yeah. We've had a couple of those.
Well, you missed the trip to DeKalb this year, though. It was cold there.
Yeah. But yeah, you know, I felt for you, too.
You were getting some plaque somewhere. And,
yeah, I got a little honor. But I was there with you in spirit.
T-shirts, hats, and...
South Florida has never gone 8-1 over a nine-game stretch. They have won nine games three previous times. As you see, the Hilltoppers will get a first down. And Western Kentucky is in uncharted territory with this Conference USA championship for Jeff Brohm in his second year. 11-2, undefeated in conference play. They rallied to beat a game Southern Miss team to win the Conference USA championship and to be undefeated. First team in Conference USA history to go undefeated and win the conference title.
In that Southern Miss game, Coach Brohm said he thought did a lot for Dowdy because they struggled early, and he was able to overcome those struggles, and we may be watching a similar performance today.
And usually these guys are front runners. Yep. Usually they get out on you and blow you away. They've blown away a lot of their opponents this year. Dowdy wants to go deep. He'll take the intermediate route. There's a strong throw caught by Dangerfield, who gets well into USF territory at about the 33-yard line. Johnny Ward on the tackle.
Dowdy's starting to heat up, and that may mean problems and trouble for USF's defense. They haven't been able to get pressure on him right here. Well, he has all day back there to read the defense. Looks at his first option, second option. He dumps it off right there in the middle of the field.
Now he's being chased. Throw on the run, and that's a terrific catch by Dangerfield.
Yeah, he's getting really, really comfortable back there in the pocket.
6-yard gain, second down and four. Let's see how fast Western Kentucky picks up the pace. Dangerfield now with five catches. Quick throw out of his hand very fast. Caught by Grant. Grant gets around inside the 20 to the 18. Red zone time for the Hilltoppers. They have a first down. Clock stopped at 3:19. Now it runs again after the placement of the ball.
Seems like the Hilltoppers have finally found a little rhythm. You know, they're not going very fast, but you know they're not going to huddle. They're going to take their time.
Yeah, they started the game going really fast with very short throws. Furby now in at the tailback spot. Now this is a more moderate pace.
Exactly.
Furby checks out. Empty backfield. Underneath, Fant inside the 10. That'll be a first down. A first and goal from the 6. Sanchez in on the stop.
That was a formational win for the Hilltoppers. Once they motioned Furby out wide and had Fant in the slot, put him one-on-one on a defender who just couldn't handle him in the slot. So that was a really good play call by head coach Brown.
20 touchdowns in the last 25 red zone visits for the Hilltoppers. They go to the ground, Furby, and he'll get back to the line of scrimmage, and that is it. Sean Hill, number 9, and here comes a flag, a couple of late flags. And it's nowhere near where the football was. Forrest Lamp, again, in there pleading his case. Maybe he is a law student in addition to an outstanding football player.
And Augie Sanchez, number 43 for the Bull Sharks, he looks like he's a little bit perturbed right now, so it may have involved him.
And Lamp is still visibly upset.
Following the play, personal foul, unnecessary roughness, offense, number 76, 15-yard penalty, second down.
Well, that is a gigantic mental error, period.
And my guess is he hit Augie Sanchez, number 43, because Augie was visibly upset after this.
Well, it's got to be more than that, though. It has to be after the play, because there was nothing wrong with that shove that we could see.
No, that's just football.
So to the 21-yard line, second down and goal from the 21. Pressure, look out here, big hit, unblocked was Ward. Third down and goal now from the 28 or 29-yard line.
After the big penalty, Tom Allen, the defensive coordinator of the Bull Sharks, decided to dial up the blitz. It was a corner fire. Dowdy never saw it coming. They're very lucky they held on to that ball.
Yep. Yeah,
very lucky.
Yep, and a timeout called by the Bulls. And you know what we're going to do? We're going to step in, talk to Chris Cotter in the studio. Chris?
Wonderful kid, too.
Yeah,
great,
yeah.
Great story. Just a heck of a talent.
But you got Baker Mayfield if you're an OU fan, and you've got similar confidence in him, and that's why that game is so good. So on third and forever, look out here. They're out of field goal range. Another sack. Eric Lee, Sean Hill, celebration time for that USF defense. Back-to-back sacks. Fourth and goal from the 38.
It seemed like Western Kentucky was out of sync on that play. When he snapped the ball, Dowdy wasn't even ready for it. I don't know how he caught the snap. And then from there, USF's front four just teed off and got to Dowdy again.
They were first and goal at the 6.
Yeah. What a costly penalty.
Yep.
By Forrest Lamp on that personal foul.
Well, let's think about the mistakes that have hurt them today. They had a penalty on defense that gave South Florida a second chance at a third down, and they score on the next play.
Exactly.
They had an interception that turned into 6 South Florida points.
Yep.
Now this has taken them, I think, out of field goal range. And they've missed some long passes. Now, Quint is telling us that he has hit from 15 warm-ups, so this is 55. We have talked quite a bit about how goofy the winds are down here.
Right.
He is an exceptional, accurate kicker as Garrett Schwettman, but he is not coming on. It's Jake Collins, the punter.
Yeah, they're going to punt.
Wow.
Yeah.
First and goal from the 6. And then the penalty that you mentioned, and back-to-back sacks. Wow. Trying to angle this and did a great job. This is a wonderful kick. Holy smokes. That's going to be down to the 3-yard line. USF is not going to have a whole lot to do. And now you have to wonder if Western Kentucky will use their timeouts. They've got all 3 of them. Hey, Quint, what do you got for us?
Dave, taking a sack there on third down is absolutely brutal. Schwettman hit in this direction from 50 in warmups. He could come not hit from 55. So that sack on third down was basically the difference of 3 points in this ballgame. The wind in this direction is slightly in our face right here in favor of the kicker.
So let's see how this first play is going to dictate who calls the next timeout.
Exactly.
And what's the approach here for Willie Taggart? How aggressive are you? We see teams send their quarterback back there and take a shot from the end zone.
I'm thinking you keep it in the Flowers' hands, let him run with it. Oh, no, he's going to take a shot down the field.
And he missed. There was a clear miscommunication. He had Kana Dillon, the tight end, 85, wide open. Instead, he tried to fit it to McCants. and McCann just kind of stopped his pattern. So now it's second down and no need to call a timeout.
Just did the Hilltoppers a huge favor with that play. A huge favor. I would have let Quentin Flowers run the ball on that play. Like a quarterback draw, motion out.
There's some big bodies coming in here now. As you said, an extra tight end. Marlon Pope, number 11, is checked in. You've got Price in the backfield, number 12. And they're going to run it with Mack. Makes a nifty move from the end zone, and Mack will get a first down. At least to the
got a flag down, though, too. We got a flag.
Yes, you do, back at the three-yard line.
Yep, this one might be coming back.
Yeah, the officials have already turned and looked at the WKU bench to get their reaction.
Holding offense, number 12, half the distance to the goal, second down.
So instead of a first down, Sean Price is hit with a holding penalty. And apparently this was an well, Price complained.
What did I do?
Yeah, but take a look here.
We're about to show you what you did, son. You hog-tied the man down, John. That's illegal in this sport, John. It's not allowed. I'm not sure that you're aware of that, but that is just not allowed in this sport, so.
So let's take a look at our Progressive Bowl Challenge Cup. Pac-12, 10 bowls, and they're rolling right along here at 2-0. The MAC has missed out on one, but they've got 7 MAC teams participating this year. CUSA doing well. Mountain West at 1-1, and the Sun Belt at 1-2, and they have just one to go.
It's going to be an interesting play call right here. You look at 2nd and 7. First down, they threw the ball incomplete. Second down, he ran the ball. Nice run, but holding. Will he go back to the air? Will he keep the ball in the hands of his quarterback, Quentin Flowers?
South Florida with one timeout. Western Kentucky with a couple. It's Mack, a conservative call. And we're going to get another timeout called by Western Kentucky immediately after a very short gain. Third down and about, 10 to go here. With 1:19 remaining in this Miami Beach Bowl first half. USF has won 8 of 9 when leading at the half.
Very interesting first half so far.
Lower scoring than I got, and I thought, frankly.
Yeah, I'm with you on that one. Yep. Yeah. And when you look at USF, I mean, they're up by a touchdown, but one touchdown is a pick six. So they've only been able to generate 7 points on offense themselves. So offensively, the teams have been even. It's just that Dowdy threw that pick six, and that's why USF is up by a touchdown right now.
So South Florida got off to just an awful start, and it looked like, Willie Taggart in his third year.
Yep.
Not going to cut it. Well, the last 8 games, he cut it. He cut himself a new contract is what he cut.
He sure did.
Because he signed through 2020. So he cut some wins and cut a deal.
Yes, sir. That's what winning can do for you.
It does. Darius Tice is the tailback. There's your run for Flowers. If he gets a block, he's got a lot of room here. And a great job to keep that from being a big play by wonderful Terry. I should have said it was a wonderful job.
Exactly.
Either way, if he doesn't cut that edge off,
right,
Flowers could plan and go. And it's 4th down. Pretty close, though, I got to say.
I thought he would get the first down had he planted that right foot and went north and south as opposed to angling towards the sideline, because he had 2 blockers in front of him. And at the same time, then he wouldn't have ran out of bounds and stopped the clock either.
I got to think you're going to go punt safe. No, they're bringing out the punt team. Although they'd leave the defense on the field. Now everybody's kind of running on at the same time. Green and gold and red and white. Just
like a hockey match or something. The way they just transferred players.
22-person line change. Fant, what's he going to do? Not much on that one. Good coverage that time by the Bulls, but still, the Hilltoppers with excellent field position. They're going to mark him down more closer to the 45 than the 42-yard line. So now with one timeout, Western Kentucky has an opportunity here with 1:06 to go. At 8:15 Eastern on ESPN, it's our Week 15 Monday Night Football matchup. Calvin Johnson and Matthew Stafford and the Lions heading to New Orleans. For an NFC battle with the Saints, Drew Brees moving in on 60,000 passing yards, 4th all-time. Monday Night Countdown, 6 o'clock Eastern. Streaming live, of course, on Watch ESPN.
That's it, Dowdy's pick six, not pick six, but Dowdy's pick that led to a touchdown.
Yes, I know what you mean.
By USF. No, he didn't throw a pick six. He just threw a pick. So I do not want to give him credit for something he did not do.
Here's a nice little catch, but a very short gain. Nicholas Norris will be 5 yards to right to midfield. So second down, Nigel Harris, who had that interception that Des just referenced. The clock is still going to run when you only have one timeout to go. You've got to pick up the pace. Short drop. Good throw, and that'll be a first down and smart move to get out of bounds. And that is Taywan Taylor, the first team All-Conference USA, who should be approaching 1,400 yards for the season. 43 seconds, first down, and they're into USF territory.
You think they're thinking field goal or a touchdown?
I think you take whatever you can get right now. Now, this is a really well set up screen in the middle to Anthony Wales, and he'll get stopped inside the 30 at about the 28-yard line. Again, the chains move. Again, the clock is stopped. There's Bird on the tackle. This is really well done. They're now in field goal range, and the clock is running again at 33.
And they run those screens so well to give defenses fits.
A little bit of blitz here, and that's an incredible catch, but for a very short gain. Made by Devin Scott, a reserve tight end, but he didn't get much, and that's going to force WKU to call their final timeout with 19 seconds remaining. That's just Scott's third catch of the year, but with Tyler Higbee out of the game. And you know what? Scott should give that football to Brandon Dowdy. Here's another record. 376th completion of the season. The record he broke was his own.
His own record?
Yeah,
of course.
I guess that wasn't very suspenseful, was it?
Well, that was an excellent catch, I tell you that. Maybe better off if he just let that ball fall incomplete.
Well, we're seeing everything about Brandon Dowdy. You could see the good, the bad, and the ugly. He's now hit on 11 straight passes. He started 4 for 4. Yeah. He had a patch of ice there that just got out of control, and now he's on a roll.
Yeah. Yeah, this is who he is. I mean, he's a streaky passer, very accurate normally, and I think that flea flicker may have got him going. I think that really got him into a rhythm, got his confidence up. Sometimes for a quarterback in a game like this, you're looking at these guys, they haven't played in over 2 weeks.
Yeah.
It takes a while for them to get going, to get the rust off.
Got a timeout now called by South Florida.
Florida, 30 seconds, timeout.
So we're out of timeouts in this half.
It's a wrap now, no more timeouts. At least not by the teams.
It is the New Year's Six. Two of the greatest days for college football fans. It all starts at noon Eastern on New Year's Eve on ESPN. That's a great game there. Houston and Florida State. Then at 4-8, your semifinals. Oklahoma, Clemson, Michigan State, Alabama. Then on New Year's Day, three more matchups to kick off 2016. NDOSU, Stanford, Iowa, and an old-fashioned slugfest in the Rose Bowl game. And Oklahoma State, Ole Miss at 8:30 in the All-State Sugar Bowl. They're all on ESPN, and, of course, they're all streaming on Watch ESPN. And, you know, I'm home for New Year's Eve.
Are you really?
Well, actually, I'm going to probably go to visit some friends, and I will insist that football be on.
There you go. As everyone should.
And you know what? They're fans. I'm not worried about it.
Oh, you'll be okay.
I'll be fine.
You'll be fine.
It's good for me. I'm thrilled. Second down here and 7. Dowdy hooks it. 12 straight completion and a big tackle there, keeping that play from getting very far. Jamie Bird. And now you've got to go, baby. You got 6, 5. Got to spike it. You get your field goal team out there, and they do it with 3 to go. Spiking it just about where shortstop is. The turf,
yes.
You covered up the baseball diamond part here, and we noticed right away the difference between the regular turf, say, in the outfield and this new sod that's been put on just for this game.
And the seams, too. The seams on the field. I mean, but so far, so good. No issues so far with the players.
It's softer where the new turf is. Schwettman, 93.3% accurate. This one from 39. He's only missed one. And that one was blocked. Nails it. Closer to 94% accuracy. So it is 14-10, USF over WKU at the half. The Bulls will get the football, the Miami Beach Bowl, the second half kickoff. Right now, let's go to Brandon Dowdy and his passing struggles. Des, he ends up 21 of 30 in the first half for 221. Quentin Flowers has only thrown 9 passes and completed just 3 for 31 for USF.
And that's a good point. I think that if I'm the Hilltoppers defensive coordinator, Nick Holt, I'm thinking we're going to stack the line of scrimmage. We're going to put 8 in the box, and we're going to make Quentin Flowers beat us with his arm. Proved us that he can make throws down the field.
You got Tyree McCants and D'Ernest Johnson, USF number 3 in the nation at kickoff returns this year as a team. This will be Johnson, and he better find the ball, and he does. That's going to interrupt momentum like crazy. Des, I doubt that happened to you very often, but what does that do to you as the returner when all of a sudden you don't even have the ball?
You know, it throws off the timing of the whole return, and, you know, some guys panic. The thing is to take a breath, and if you can, grab it, and go north and south as fast as possible.
And you see Quentin Flowers getting into the end zone as fast as possible for the first USF touchdown. This was the second by Rodney Adams off of an interception. And it was 14-0 USF, and a slow start for Dowdy.
Yeah, he was, 9 for 13 before the interception. And after the interception, he had 12 straight passes for 161 yards. The only thing that cooled him off was halftime.
Marlon Mack, as he runs into Nick Holt Jr., the son of the defensive coordinator, who was almost right there when his son made the hit. And a good carry for Mack. Of 9, a second and short coming up. You're going to give him the first down. It is a first down. Mack again. Hole opens up, and he'll get just to the 35, I think they're going to give him. Brandon Leston, number 31, had an interception in the Conference USA title game in there to make a stop out of the Clearwater area, which is not at all far from where USF is located in Tampa. And USF playing with a little bit of pace. And now we have a whistle. I'm looking. I don't see any flags, though. Head linesman talking to one of the timing officials. And there might be an issue here with the down and distance markers.
Come on, guys.
The 35.
Well, when J.Ro Keach, the voice of University of Miami Baseball, says that it's first
it will
and
be
10.
Second down and 1 half yard.
It's second down.
There you go.
Stick the baseball, Jay. Now, so that was the issue.
Okay.
And the officials communicating and getting it right. So they did not get the first down, even though the sticks were moved to first down.
Right.
He knew something was up because you saw Western Kentucky's coaches pointing at the yard marker.
Yep.
They identified that immediately.
So Darius Tice is the tailback, number 31. Rodney Adams shifting out to the left of the quarterback. Quentin Flowers, the sophomore from Miami. Tice. And he'll get the first down. Nick Holt Jr. with another stop.
Surprised to see the Hilltoppers defense staying a too high safety look. Not dropping the safety down, even though the only thing that USF has been able to do so far on offense is run the ball. But they don't think they need to drop a guy down. Now they drop a safety down now.
And Flowers off the zone read, takes off, gets a good block. And he'll get into WKU territory at around the 45-yard line. That's an 18-yard pickup. Prince Charles Awara on the stop for the Hilltoppers.
Flowers is like just a magician back there because you don't know if he has the ball, if he's going to give it to a running back. Just really good with hiding the ball and confusing the defense.
Flowers takes off again. Directing traffic, needs a block, and didn't quite get it. Adams realized he was about to make an illegal block in the back and just sort of gave it up rather than take the penalty.
Which was a smart move by Adams. He's trying to figure out what Flowers is going to do. Are you going to throw it to me or try to block? Oh, okay, all right, well, hey, I'll just shield him with my body.
So it's another first down, though. The legs of Flowers, so dangerous. Hand off here to Mack. Makes one miss. Now he's got Flowers again as his lead blocker, and Mack will get a little bit short of the first down. He might have it. It's going to be interesting to see what the linesman does with this. Brown on the stop. That's the second time that Flowers has given himself up on a play like that when they've reversed the field.
And I tell you what, you just win the confidence of your team when you do things like that as a quarterback. And how about Marlon Mack? What a move in the backfield. What a turn nothing into something. He's such an exciting, dynamic runner with the ball in his hands.
He got the first down. Two Flowers. Pump once. And that just skipped. Just took way too much off. And Rodney Adams was intended receiver there. It'll be second down and 10.
Yeah, when you watch your quarterback out there as a lead blocker and he's giving his body up for you, I mean, you just want to go out there and win for a guy like that. And that's why he's the true leader of South Florida's football team. They love this kid, offense and defense. A coach told us a story about when he was over his house for dinner and the running back said, hey, you know what? Why don't you be that guy who we see at practice sometimes? You know, lead us. Show your personality. And ever since then, Flowers has been a different player.
Tice is pushed out of bounds by Leston. Picked up a couple. Be third down and 8. They are definitely in range of Emilio Nadelman, the field goal kicker. We have not seen much out of him except for PATs. 1 out of 6 on third downs, though, USF so far.
Third and 8. They're going 1 single high safety. Put a man in the box.
Flags. Could be third and longer coming up. Let's see if it's a false start. What do we have? No, maybe not. USF seems pretty pleased with this.
Defense, number 92, 5-yard penalty, third down.
G-Money. Cost him 5 yards there. Now it's 3rd and 3. That reopens the playbook, I would imagine, if you're Willie Taggart. And I also think it brings 4th down into play.
Yeah, that's really, really costly penalty by G Money and my brother's keeper Brown. see what USF can do with it.
There's that check with me, where you're lined up and try to give the indication you're ready to go, but you're not.
They got cover 0. They're locked up across the board. Look at that motion. Man across the board.
Oh, what a move by Flowers in traffic. Another flag is down. He is right around the mark first down. He kind of fell down after making a great move.
I think an offensive line tackle for Marius Bryant, number 9 for the Hilltoppers.
Offense, number 75. 10-yard penalty, third down.
But that was an exceptional move by Flowers right there.
Amachias with a penalty.
Nick Holt, he broke Nick Holt down on that move. But it doesn't count. They got to bring it back. Let's see if the Hilltoppers go cover 0 again.
That was an awesome move, though. We just got another look at it. So now it's 3rd down and 13. We have not seen USF take many deep shots in this game. That's Adams in motion. Fake to him. Flowers trying to find his way through, and they're waiting for him. 4th down and 10 coming up. John Morris on the stop for WKU, number 3, one of the best defensive players they have, a senior from Albany, Georgia, who used to play at UAB.
Yeah.
And stepped in right away and became a leader in the only year he's playing with these guys.
Instantly. A guy they really have a lot of respect for, too. They say he was a leader from day one. Can you imagine how difficult that was for him transferring programs? Yep. As soon as he stepped on campus, he became an instant leader for the football team. Really smart player, too.
Nadelman has made his last 9 field goals. This one from about 43. And the streak is over. So WKU's defense holds. And now the offense, led by Brandon Downey, will get their first opportunity of this third quarter. And right now, let's see, that would be short right field is where the football is. Where Ichiro often patrols. He's re-signed with the Marlins. And that's where we're going to find Western Kentucky getting their first carries behind Anthony Wales. Wales, who had 38 yards in the first half. And let's check in from the WKU perspective with Quint Kesnick.
The biggest issue we are facing in protection, according to Jeff Brom, is a lack of blocking at the tight end and running back position. It's been the Bulls' edge rush that he has found to be most detrimental. On Brandon Doughty, didn't like the way he looked early in the game. He said he's now settled down, taking what's there. Said the Bulls don't take the bait. They're really disciplined and patient in their zone coverage. So he's going to have to check things down, survey the field, and be patient.
He nearly threw a pick as you were saying that. Dietrich Nichols jumped the route, and it's going to be third down and four.
South Florida's trying to bring a little blitz, too. They brought blitz the last two plays. And actually, Dietrich Nichols sat on that last pass and almost picked it off.
Doughty with great time. Oh, that's a great throw. Down to the 40. This is Norris. Foot race to the end zone. They're not going to catch him.
Nope.
And the Hilltoppers lead for the first time today.
And that's what it takes for this offense. I mean, they have some excellent receivers, guys who can go the distance, just get the ball to their hands and let them do the work. Nichols Norris is one of their best players. He's a slot receiver. He loves to work in the middle of the field. He has a great feel for it. A guy who Brom told us he thought that he could have an impact, because once you go to that 4-2-5 defense and you start putting hybrid players on crafty slot receivers, it's all over. Doughty's going to take that any day of the week.
The longest streak in FBS continues. That's a touchdown pass in 28 consecutive games for the redshirt senior from Davie, Florida. And a 14-0 lead has not only been erased, it has been overcome by WKU with 9:43 to go in the third quarter. Nicholas Norris, another Miamian out of Booker T. Washington, gets his fifth touchdown of the season and the 46th thrown by Doughty this season. Are the Bands,
yeah,
without question.
True. Definitely, yep.
And while the NFL is the tremendous product and some of the best athletes in the world,
they don't have a band.
No, they don't. No, they do not.
That's one thing we missed when I was playing up there in Green Bay with the Packers, was a band.
You know, you think with that atmosphere that they would have a band.
They would love it up there, I'm telling you. Packer fans would love it.
Except, of course, when it gets really cold and the instruments freeze to their lips.
There you have it.
Yeah.
Therein lies the problem.
Really short kickoff, a little skipper taken by McCants, or make that Dearness Johnson, and Johnson will get outside the 20 to the 22-yard line. Let's review that touchdown pass.
I tell you what, man, it's like taking candy from a baby. When you can get a guy like Nicholas Norris, who's a very crafty slot receiver, one-on-one with a guy like Jamie Bird. Jamie's known for his hitting, not for his cover skills. Doughty's going to take that matchup every day, all day, and there's no way Bird's going to catch Nicholas Norris once he's out there in the open field.
So for the first time today, Quentin Flowers leading an offense that's now behind in the ball game, but only by three. Marlon Mack stretching it outside, and that's it. Boy, he is dropped. And Holt missed him the first time, but Dijon Brown did not. Maybe a yard there. We'll call it second down and nine to go.
And even though Holt didn't make the tackle, he did a great job of just making them go east and west, stretching it to the sideline so another defender could make that tackle. Did not let Mack turn up the field, because once that guy squares his shoulder and goes north and south, he's hard to catch.
He does have 100 yards today. Flowers in a little bit of trouble, and Mack signaled, give me the ball, and then he dropped it. Mack was there. It's going to be third down and nine.
It seems like USF's offense is just out of sync right now. They just can't get anything going. Nothing's smooth with them right now. It seems like a constant battle uphill for USF's offense so far.
That's five straight incompletions for Quentin Flowers.
And I tell you what, you got to give Nick Holt, the defensive coordinator of the Hilltoppers, a lot of credit, because he's mixing up his fronts too, causing some issues for USF's offensive line.
Flowers having a scramble. Now, he's an excellent runner. He wants to throw, almost crossed the line of scrimmage, and then went back to a different receiver, a Johnson, who fell down. So it's fourth down and nine.
And you look at Flowers, he's like yelling at his receivers, telling guys you're not in the area where you're supposed to be. They're really out of sync right now. I mean, it's almost looking like schoolyard football when you watch USF play right now so far.
Western Kentucky has taken a little bit charge of this game. Fant waiting for the punt at around the 40-yard line from Brent Gordon punting today instead of Chibate. High. It's a really good kick. Fair catch. In between the 30 and 35-yard lines. 8:48 to go, and Brandon Dowdy has found a hot hand. He will lead the Hilltoppers offense back on the field when we return. Down those last-minute gifts, which I know Quint has not done yet. You can watch football whilst shopping. Empty set here for Brandon Dowdy and WKU. And they go right to the pass, caught by Grant. And Grant will get out to the 38, 39-yard line. Lee on the stop.
I tell you what, I think Brandon Dowdy and the Hilltoppers, it seems like they're in their element right now. They're really comfortable with the rhythm of the offense. They've noticed something on defense that they can take advantage of. You know, USF's front four, Coach Brom told us, will be the best front four they've seen since they played LSU. And we saw that in the first half.
Yes.
But now the play calling has neutralized the Bull Sharks front four, and the Hilltoppers are able to move the ball efficiently and effectively.
Well, Dowdy has broken his own records. He broke his own record today for passing yards in a season. He's over almost 4,900 yards. He's thrown a touchdown pass in 28 consecutive games, the longest streak in FBS. And he's got a man wide open here at the 30-yard line to the 20. It's Norris again, and they hook up one more time for six.
Nicholas Norris. Before the game, we said he may be with the impact player, and he's proven us right. This guy right now is on fire. They have no answer for the Hilltoppers passing attack. They neutralized USF's front four, and now they're just throwing the ball all over the field. This is the Brandon Dowdy that we've seen all season long. I mean, no one's within 10 yards of Nicholas Norris. So I think it's safe to say that was a blown coverage. Nicholas Norris so far today, 4 receptions, 124 yards, and 2 touchdowns. And I keep calling USF's defense the Bull Sharks because Tom Allen says that's how they like to be identified. That's their identity. When they came here and took over the program, to the defense, the team didn't have an identity. And when he was at Ole Miss, they were the Land Sharks. So this team loves to be called defensively the Bull Sharks.
Well, we're celebrating its 11th year sponsoring the Good Hands Field Goal Nets. Allstate making contributions to participating universities' general scholarship funds for each field goal and extra point kick. So that means somebody from Allstate just wrote a check right now. Allstate has contributed millions in scholarship monies to date. 24-14, and WKU is scoring and scoring quickly.
Yes, they are. Things have taken a really quick turn in this Miami Beach Bowl.
Western Kentucky trying for a 12th win on the season.
And Nicholas Norris down the right sideline, just all by himself, no one within 10 to 12 yards of him. Easy touchdown. I tell you what, man, they're doing a really good job, Jeff Brom and that offensive staff now, of neutralizing that front four and giving their guy, Brandon Dowdy, time to deliver passes out there.
Boy, that's a big thing. So much, if you're just joining us in the first half, South Florida took a 14-0 lead, and their front four really getting pressure on Dowdy and screwing up his rhythm. And you heard Quint mention that Jeff Brom had emphasized protection was going to be key in this half, and he's getting that protection now. And WKU flag coming in behind that return by Johnson, and it didn't get USF very many yards out to the 20. And this may be driving them back even further, closer to the third base dugout here at Marlins Park. Back officiating crew, Rick.
Illegal block in the back. Return team number 44. Half the distance. First down, South Florida.
And it just gets a little tougher for Willie Taggart's team.
especially when you look at the fact that Quentin Flowers, he hasn't completed a pass since the first quarter.
Missed his last six.
Wow.
How about the fact he's only thrown six since the first quarter?
And now you're down two scores to the team whose offense just seems like they're on fire. This is a very important series right now for USF's offense.
Do they do it on the ground with Mack and Flowers, or do they try to go to the air? We'll start with Mack. That's always a wise choice, but they're waiting for him. Chased out of bounds after a short gain. DeJuan Brown, the senior from Beaumont, California, has played a big game, number 17 in red and white. Now we have a USF player, a lineman, slow to get up and unable to get up, as a matter of fact, at the 8-yard line. And that appears to be Dominique Threet, the right guard, a junior from Atlanta.
It'll be second and 9.
So the Bulls training staff will come out and see what the issue here of Dominique. We did not see it ourselves as the play was going on, but it seems at the moment defensively that WKU
and defensively, you look at Nick Holt's defense, and they're teeing off up front. It's like, we don't respect your passing game. We know you're going to run the ball. Until you can prove to us you can throw it, we're going to stack the box. Stack the effectively too. So,
and the big fella working his way to his feet.
Yeah, like he got rolled up on.
Yeah, that's, it's a threat that you can't see.
Right,
it comes in from behind, and that's the biggest danger I think the offensive linemen face. They're so focused on what's in front of them, understandably, and they sometimes get hit when they don't see it. While we have a moment here, let's get to our latest dish, and it is brought to you by Dish. We have coming up tomorrow night on ESPN at 7 o'clock, Temple Toledo at the Marmo Boca Raton Bowl at the beautiful FAU Stadium. The Military Thursday, and then the St. Petersburg Bowl Saturday morning at 11 o'clock, UConn and Marshall. Marshall, the Conference USA champions last year. They won the inaugural Boca Raton Bowl. That'll be on ESPN.
May take a ride up the street and check out that Boca Raton Bowl tomorrow.
You please do, and come say hello.
Yeah, get a couple of tickets to that one. That'll be fun.
It will be a good game. Absolutely. It'll be more of a defensive-oriented game, I think.
Yeah. Yes.
Temple
Definitely.
Toledo.
Yep.
And you see Jason Candle debuting as Toledo's head coach.
Yes, sir.
Flowers takes the slot, the safety valve, I should say, and that's a well above average safety valve as Rodney Adams gets out of the shadow of the end zone and all the way to around the 40-yard line. Great presence that time by Flowers and great communication by Adams.
And a just excellent run by Adams, too. First, he had to go down and get the ball because it wasn't a well-thrown pass, but then once the ball in his hands, you know, he's a guy who they think can make some magic happen, and you saw it right there. He turned nothing to something right there. Really good block on the edge, too.
And now Adams again. That's his second straight completion or catch after two straight completions from Flowers. Holt in there on the stop. Looks like it's going to be about a yard short of a first down. And now USF playing with some pace and confidence. Play action fake to Mack. Flowers, if he can get the edge, he's got some room to run on the run, and it's dropped at the 40-yard line. Bronson had it. I don't know if Flowers could have possibly thrown that ball any better. Third down in a yard.
That was a good throw by Flowers, especially rolling to his left, right-handed quarterback. Placed it where only the receiver could catch it. You got to make that catch for your quarterback. Make that catch for your offense. You got to get something going.
Third down conversions. They're well off of their nearly 40% complete percentage. 1 of 8. I suspect this is two down territory, too, if they don't get it. No, they don't. It's Mack. Close. McCollum on the stop. Honorable mention, Conference USA linebacker.
The Hero Toppers are going zero coverage, putting everybody at the line of scrimmage, and still daring, just daring Quentin Flowers to throw the ball.
8 of 15 on fourth downs this year is USF. None bigger than this one. Whistles, timeout. Yep. Play clock had worked its way down to about 7, and Willie Tiger wants a timeout.
South Florida.
Tell you what, this is a very important down and distance for them, so I understand that timeout.
Yeah, they got to get it right. Yeah. And it seemed like at first with about 12, 13 seconds to go, I don't know if the play call had even gotten in yet.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I think Willie Taggart, who runs the offense, both these coaches calling plays. Taggart engineering one of the best turnarounds, in-season turnaround. When he talked to everybody yesterday, the coaching staff, they admitted it. 1-3, they're playing Syracuse, who's never an easy win.
Exactly.
And they're thinking, gosh, if we go to 1-4, we don't really know what's going to happen here.
Right. No, you're right.
And instead, they went 7-8, and they clobbered a couple of good American Conference teams at Temple and Cincinnati.
No, they really did. You got to give Willie Taggart, his coaching staff, credit for just staying the course and keeping the guys focused. And they really bounced back, and they had a tremendous season. They really did. So but this is a crucial 4th-and-1 for USF.
Now you've got that Baylor alignment.
Yeah.
With the big gaps, the receivers, and sort of, I would call it an I formation. The get back coach for Western Kentucky getting a workout, keeping Nick Holt off the field. A lot of motion. They're going to run a wide with Adams, and he slipped. But did he get the first down?
Well, the USF players think so.
The campaigning is underway.
Yes, sir.
They're near, of course, the Hilltoppers sideline. And I think they got it based by where the football is. Yep, it's a first down. That is not the prettiest 4th-and-1 play you'll ever see, but they got the one.
They got what they needed to keep the chains moving.
They go back to that Baylor alignment. And more whistles. So forget about the play down the field, and let's see what we have here. And our referee, Greg Plump, is not happy with whatever he was just told.
Prior to the snap, the Western Kentucky has challenged the ruling of a first down.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
All right. So we'll go to the replay.
Let's see. They're going to challenge the spot, huh?
Well, it's the third quarter. I can't stand it when teams use challenges in the first half.
Right.
But in the second half, it makes much more sense to me. And if they get the football back with all the momentum.
Let's see.
Now, he slipped. Now, that's a tough angle. The ruling on the field is a first down. We have to have that ultra-perfect video evidence to overturn the call. That's a better look right there.
To me, it looks like he got it.
If you watch the official at the top of your screen, he is following that play all the way.
With that ball in his right hand, he braced himself with his left hand when he fell.
Yep.
I think that he got it. I think he got the first down.
I think that brace saved him.
Exactly.
So WKU will lose a timeout for that challenge if it's unsuccessful. Now, let's see.
Yeah.
Review, the ruling of a first down stands.
Yeah.
Western Kentucky has lost his challenge. It has no challenges remaining for the game. It has charged a team timeout. It's first.
So both teams now with two timeouts for the remainder of this game. Jeff Brom says, okay, it was worth a gamble. Got to try it.
Yep. But that was the right call.
I think so, too. I think right that was call. A remarkable play by Adams to use his hand.
Exactly. To brace himself when he was falling and keep the ball in his right hand just to get enough of that first down.
You know, I said Jeff Brom was understanding the call. Apparently not. He is still pleading. He's not going to win, though, and he knows it. So USF hit one big. Flowers on the run, way overthrown. He misses receiver
but we
by
got a
20
flag.
Yards,
Might
and there is a flag
foul.
Down. Yeah, we could get roughing the passer here.
But that's the game plan. If I'm the Hilltoppers, I'm loading the box.
Personal foul, roughing the passer. Defense, number 9.
Yeah.
15-yard penalty, automatic. First down.
Yeah, if I'm the Hilltoppers defense, I'm loading the box, and I'm going to make Flowers throw the ball every down that he's on the field.
And that's the right call. Now, it's not the second hit. It was 9, Omarius Bryant, who came up with the first hit, and that was the one that was flagged. You have now an interesting formation here with Johnson, number 32, Mack, and Tice all in the backfield in a kind of a diamond formation. And it'll be Tice on the carry with Johnson leading the way. And Tice will get bumped out of bounds by Marcus Ward after picking up 3. Second and 7 coming up.
They like to run that formation, that inverted wishbone diamond formation, because they can get 3 runners on the field plus Flowers. Puts a lot of pressure on the defense, especially when you can get out there on the edge and get to the perimeter.
Yeah, you're right. With Flowers, they run into kind of zone reads, and they just send the play one way and go the other with Flowers. And now it looks like they're going to try a little pass here down the field. Touchdown, USF! McCant from D'Ernest Johnson.
Well, if Flowers can't throw it, let's let D'Ernest throw it. I mean, a little trickeration by USF that paid off. And what a play call, too. Same formation. The diamond formation, you get the defense sucked up, play action, and D'Ernest Johnson was just a beautiful throw. I mean, you couldn't have placed that ball better. What a throw. So a little trickeration paid off for USF's offense.
8 plays, 92 yards in 2 minutes and 51 seconds, including a 4th down and 1 where they got 4th down and about 1 yard and 1 inch when they needed it. Survived the challenge and continued the drive, and then went into the playbook for D'Ernest Johnson to throw the touchdown pass.
This is what I'm talking about. This is what I expected out of this game. Some trick plays, a lot of points. Now these guys, I think the offensive play callers are starting to get into their groove too. Willie Taggart and Jeff Brohm. So we have a ball game on our hands, gentlemen.
Well, you saw the DB just peek into the backfield, and he was done when that happened. That's a new school record of total yards for USF. They're approaching 5,500 on the year. Their improvement in stats over from 2 years ago when Taggart took over, and they struggled and won only 2 games. They won just 4 last year. Now they're looking at a chance to get to 9, and this is still a fairly new program.
Yes.
Taggart's only the 3rd coach they've ever had.
I know. Wow, right?
Amazing. Dick Leavitt and Skip Holtz and now Willie Taggart, so it's still new.
It really is. And Leavitt did such a tremendous job with that,
really
that program.
Built it literally shovel by shovel.
Yes, exactly.
All right, now. You've got Kylan Towner and Nikarius Fant awaiting this kickoff. This will be Towner, who's run one back for a touchdown this year. And he'll get out to the 30, maybe the 31-yard line. Got everybody excited in Hilltopperville. We want to remind everybody tomorrow on ESPN, Capital One Bowl Mania continues. We've got the famous Idaho Potato Bowl with Akron versus Utah State at 3:30 Eastern. And at 7, the Marmo Boca Raton Bowl, Temple Toledo. And it could very well be a slugfest at 7 o'clock. That'll be on ESPN. It is the most wonderful time of the year. You can always find it streaming live on Watch ESPN. So Brandon Dowdy comes out, 24 of 35, 354 yards, 2 TDs, and a pick. Anthony Wales is his tailback. That's a backwards pass, and a double pass coming up from Fant. Wide open. Oh, he couldn't hang on. Grant had nobody near him.
Oh, I tell you what, Dave, these offensive coordinators,
Jeff Braun right out the gate, a double pass. He said, you did that. We can do one better. Check this out. Almost a completion, too. I mean, no one was out there.
There's a 20-yard cushion or more.
Oh, man.
Look how long it's going to. We may never be able to show you a USF receiver on that replay. A defender, I should say.
Yeah. Woo. These guys are.
The coaches are balling.
Yes, they are. Exactly.
It's a four-yard gain. Third down and six coming up. Oh, my gosh.
This is fun.
It's supposed to be, man. It's a bowl game.
Exactly.
You know, we're not playing for a national championship here, but we're playing for advancing your program, especially two teams that are on the rise as these two are.
Yep.
Underneath, good looking pass there, and Grant will hang on to that one and move the sticks. Sanchez on the stop for Tom Allen's defense. They call themselves the Bull Sharks, and we have a USF player hurt. I think that's a USF player on the far sideline.
I think it's Dietrich Nichols, number three, the cornerback.
My point was going to be, when you have so many bowl games, that people have been a little critical of it, but it's such an important thing, and you never hear the players complaining about it, by the way. You don't hear players or coaches complaining about bowl games. They appreciate the experience. The coaches love the extra practices, and it's a chance to showcase your program nationally.
Right. Yeah, yeah. No, you're right about that. Only complaint is, man, I wish we could have played earlier.
Yep.
These guys were ready to come out here and play this game.
And I think you brought up a great point early, Des, that there was some rust, especially in the offensive end in that first quarter.
Yes.
And now we're seeing these offenses begin to hum a little bit, and the play caller is getting cockier as the game goes on. So hopefully Jamie Berg will be able to return for the defense for the Bulls. Dowdy, long pass. Oh, that's a sweet little catch. Does it count? Yes, it does. Jared Dangerfield, but there is a flag down way back where Dowdy was. I think this is going against USF.
I think so, too.
Roughing the passer.
Yep, roughing the
defense,
passer call.
Number nine. The 15-yard penalty will be added.
It's going to be on Sean Hill.
Automatic. First down.
That's going to add 15 more.
And that's one thing you can't do, is give them momentum like this. Obviously, the Hilltoppers are rolling, and then you have a personal foul, roughing the passer.
Let's see if he caught this. Wow, that is as we've said this before.
No, they're going to challenge it.
Are they actually challenging, or is the booth buzzing down?
Someone's going to look at this one again. I think it's the booth. Yeah, I think it's the booth.
Well, we took one look at it, and we had a great look at it. And right. Again, using that standard of indisputable video evidence, I don't know if you're going to be able to overturn this one. Just at the first glance. We'll get a few more glances, of course. You don't see any chalk come up, but that's soft around that part of the field because that's usually baseball dirt. Oh, wait a minute. You know what?
I think he's out.
I think you're right.
I think he's out.
I think you're absolutely right. I think the part of that foot was just a hair OB.
Yeah, I think he's out.
Now, from that angle, not so much, but the original, the first angle we just showed, and here we go again.
Such a nice, clean catch, too, but that looks like a... If he's a size 11 and a half, if he was 11, he'd be in. He'd be good, but.
Well, we looked to our booth official today, John Sullivan. He's in touch with the replay booth. And now, here's a key.
Go ahead.
The pad has come out. When the pad comes out,
it
often means an overturn because they've got to get the details right about where to put the football, anything to do with the clock, and any of the other stuff.
Right.
So
it's a good point.
You do have the penalty, however.
That, so yeah,
they,
exactly.
Now this becomes, all right, where are we going to put the ball and so forth. So
yeah.
That's always a big, that's your tip of the day right there. Watch for the, whoever the referee's companion is, in this case, the back judge.
Yeah, and you would think maybe it would be kind of hard for them to tell because he's wearing white shoes and he's right there on the sideline. But I think that, to me, it's this obvious. He was just a little bit over that line when his foot, his right foot came down. A shoe shorter, he'd be okay. Come on, guys, let's get this together.
After review, the ruling of a completed catch will be reversed to an incomplete catch. The receiver had his foot out of bounds when he caught the ball. The roughing the passer call will be enforced. It will be first and 10 for South Florida at the 39-yard line. First down.
He meant Western Kentucky there.
That's okay. You know what he meant. I think they got that one right, too.
The replay official is Rick Jackson. Communicator is Steve Barnes from the Mid-American Conference. The good old Mac.
We're so focused on that catch or the incompletion, we never got a chance to see the personal foul.
All right, we're going to take a look. If you look to the left of your screen, a little contact after the play.
Okay.
So,
all righty.
Seen worse, I must admit.
Much worse.
We didn't see the whole thing follow all the way through.
True.
So now the ball is at the 39-yard line. The penalty counts. Wipe out the catch. 3:40 to go in the third quarter. What is becoming, and you know, last year's game was pretty memorable here at Marlins Park, and this one is on pace to be just as memorable. Furby is the tailback. It's Grant on the carry, and Grant will get to around the 32-yard line before he is dragged down by Nate Godwin.
Some good blocks on the perimeter by Norris and Furby. Keeping it on the ground. Nice solid run. We're going to put some pressure on the defense, though. And go very fast now.
And Dowdy could be changing the play.
Look out for Johnny Ward.
And now he's going to go over and confirm everything. No, he's still got time. Got 10 seconds to get rid of the ball. And it's a handoff. Furby makes one miss. Showed some nifty footwork. That was a nice little cutback in traffic. And with Augie Sanchez on the stop, Furby gains 8, and it's a first down. How about the big fella?
Yeah, 240 pounds. He showed a little nifty footwork right there. I'm just used to him running guys over, just going north and south. But he said, hey, I can make you miss in my game, too.
Redshirt freshman, by the way. Very bad news for everybody else in Conference USA. Dowdy, looking end zone, takes underneath instead, and breaking a tackle is Grant, and a touchdown saving tackle perhaps at the 10-yard line. Ball came out very late. That will not be a fumble. Let's check in with Quint.
Signs of fatigue, poor tackling, lack of a pass rush. Western Kentucky time of possession in that first half was 19 minutes, and I think that's starting to pay off now.
They have 21-13 right now, Quinn, as opposed to 18-52 for USF.
And their best defensive player, Jamie Bird, number two, just went back out the game.
Look out, here we go, the reverse. That's Fant, gets a block, and into the end zone. Touchdown!
Earlier, we talked about Quentin Flowers blocking. Just make sure you get a good look at Brandon Dowdy right here, blocking on the perimeter. He's the one, to me, that gave him the block for the touchdown. Look at Brandon Dowdy right there. He lines him up. You don't have to, you know, destroy the man. Just get in front of him.
Yep.
Tie him up a little bit. Good job by Brandon Dowdy.
Nice move there by Fant.
Yeah, to get Fant to the end zone.
Oh, Dowdy did lock up with him a little bit.
A little bit. I mean, I respect that. He's probably on the sideline talking about, hey, guys, you see that block? Did you see the block?
Hey, Mel Kiper, did you see the block?
Good job. Good job.
WKU reclaims their 10-point lead on a 69-yard drive, seven plays in just under 3 minutes with a minute 56 to go in this Miami Beach Bowl in the third quarter. And what is really interesting is you see Bird still having a little bit of trouble there on the training table. Do not know if he's going to be able to come back into the game or not. Is the aggressiveness, I mean, all of a sudden we're seeing flea flickers and double passes and reverses. And,
yeah.
You know, and we still got a long way to go.
Yeah, still got a whole quarter left. And but I think WKU, they're having fun, especially offensively. They're in their element right now. Mentally, they're exactly where they want to be. USF cannot say the same thing for them. They're struggling.
459 total yards for the Hilltoppers, 381 in the air. You've got Adams and McCants back deep. Now, Adams is the dangerous kick returner, number 87. Broke one against Navy. Led the American Conference in kickoff returns this year. And he'll get a shot at it right here. And they're ready for him. No chance. That directional kick pinned him back. And he is swarmed under by WKU special teams at the 12-yard line. So bad field position for Quinton Flowers. So the last six drives for Western Kentucky, after a very slow start, they did not score in the first quarter. They have put up four touchdowns and a field goal in the last six drives. And four of those drives under 2 minutes, two of them under 1 minute. This is Mack on the carry. Gets a couple of good blocks. I think that was Adams, number 87, who had a great block. And that's a solid gain of eight. But T.J. McCollum and Brian Shorter on the stop for the Hilltoppers defense, coordinated by Nick Holt, whose son is an outstanding linebacker. First team Conference USA, number 10.
Let's see what South Florida's offense can do right here on this drive. Last drive ended with a trick play for a touchdown. A little razzle-dazzle.
And Marlon Mack now has set a new single-season rushing record, 1,282 yards for USF.
I say until the Hilltoppers prove they can stop them, I'll feed them.
Flowers in trouble here. Let's see about his ad-libbing skills. And he didn't even have to throw it there. He was already out of bounds at the 15-yard line. Just a low snap, couldn't handle it. And instead of second down and two, now we're looking at third down and long. And I tell you, one problem for USF has been rotten field position, Des. Their last five starts have been either their own. 3, 14, 22, 8, and 12.
Wow.
Those are bad lottery numbers. Never mind bad numbers to start your drive.
No, you're not kidding.
And they're going to rule that an incomplete pass. That's what made that so interesting. It's third and two. Mack broke a tackle, fell forward, didn't get it. That was Nick Holt who ruined that play. It's fourth down.
I tell you, Nick Holt does a really good job of affecting plays, even when he may not make the tackle, but he slows things down offensively, especially for a guy like Mack. Because if Mack would have hit that full speed, he would have got that first down. So really good job by Nick Holt, slowing them down, making sure you can't get to the edge. And that's what you want to do with number five. You want him to get to the edge so he can turn the corner and go north to south.
USF has been bad on first down, 10% today. Fant made the first one miss, made a few more miss. Fant, 40, 35, another cutback. Fant, another cutback, and he's going to be down at around the 26-yard line. We have another bull shaking up on the play. What a spectacular punt return by Fant.
Man, that was spectacular, Dave. I thought that he was going to be tackled by the first man down. He took a huge risk right here. Turned around and got north and south and just started dancing, putting guys in the blender, shaking them up. Did that nasty move to the punter. Oh, man. Yeah, what a huge return by Fant. Yeah,
that was impressive. And, you know, Quint mentioned how USF dragging a little bit defensively.
Yeah.
And you're seeing guys get a little tired. Devin Abraham is now shaken up.
Yeah, it wasn't fair what Fant did to Brent Gordon, the punter. This is his first action.
I know. He wasn't even expecting to play.
You put me out here in space against Fant one-on-one? Oh, man. It's like, man, I'm telling people, I'm texting my friends, I get to play today in the Miami Beach Bowl. And here I am one-on-one with...
Oh, and he gets popped, too.
Yeah,
that is adding injury to insult in this case.
Yeah.
So a 37-yard return off of the 41-yard punt. We have 11 ticks remaining in this third quarter.
Yeah. I think it's safe to say that Western Kentucky, as of right now, they're hitting with all cylinders, offense, defense, and special teams.
Let's check in quickly with Quint.
Dave, here comes a shot on first down. If you follow Jeff Brohm this season, off of sudden change with good field position, he likes to roll the dice.
Where would he go? Who is the guy? And there we go. Looking end zone. You're right. Doughty over the middle. Dangerfield. Oh, what a grab. Touchdown. WKU.
Top 10 play right there. To catch that ball at his highest point, to take the hit that he took, turn into like a human helicopter, and to hold on to the ball. Outstanding play by Jared Dangerfield. And and this is what they like to do, too. The crossing routes to try to confuse the secondary. And like Quinn said, they're going to take a shot. Sudden change. We're going to the end zone.
How about the protection? Again, that's the biggest difference if you have not been with us all afternoon. That kind of protection for Doughty was not available in the first half,
right,
particularly the first quarter when he struggled.
And what they did, they were able to run the ball, so now they're doing everything off of play action. That was a play action scissors route.
And a tip of the cap to our good friend on the sideline for noticing that as well. Well, I've got so many records that have just been broken.
Ridiculous.
We'll look at this while I tell you that Brandon Doughty now has 11 straight games with at least 3 touchdown passes.
Yeah.
That's the 50th touchdown of the season. That's a new school record. And he just broke Colt Brennan's FBS 2-year record for touchdowns. Now Doughty has 97 in 2 seasons.
Well, I tell you what, he's giving that NFL scout what he came to see.
Yep.
This is his 6th 400-yard game of the season.
And he showed him resiliency, too, because there was an absolute stretch where he was leaking oil. No question about it.
Yeah.
And he has come back and played like the Brandon Doughty that threw for 4,594 yards in the regular season. He now has 48 incredible touchdown passes on the year. But Dangerfield, Nat Moore just called to tell how much he enjoyed the Jared Dangerfield catch, because Nat is known for the helicopter hit in the NFL, and Jared Dangerfield almost matched that right there.
Wow. 28 points for Western Kentucky in the third quarter alone. That's incredible.
Now D'Ernest Johnson. Flag comes in. Johnson is belted at the 33-yard line. There are 2 flags down from our MAC crew. What could be the final play of the third quarter?
During the return, holding, return team number 44, 10-yard penalty. First down, South Florida. That's the end of the third quarter.
Well, South Florida is a story of resilience this year, and they're going to have to be very resilient against the team that is very good in the lead. And the lead is the largest of the day for Western Kentucky. Have you been on yet with Scott?
Yeah, I would. Yeah, I would.
Okay, good.
Good.
So everything's clear.
Yeah.
He got the message.
Loud and clear.
Very nice. In the third quarter, WKU put up 28 points, as Des mentioned, 222 yards in that quarter alone.
Impressive. They made some great halftime adjustments too, Dave.
Now you got to play some D. Flowers, he's going to go deep down the middle of the field. And it's going to be touchdown, Bulls Adams!
Dave, I'm trying to tell you, this guy Adams is having a day. He is having a huge game. The most improved player on the team is showing you exactly why. Very consistent. The screen passes to him have been great today. He scored on a jet sweep, and now a post route, a deep post route. And what, hey, how about the throw by Flowers? You know, we've been waiting for that all afternoon, and finally, a bomb by Quentin Flowers. So this is what we expected.
It's a ball game, man. Come on. Well, that's a disruptive effort at breaking up the extra point by Bryant. And it's offside.
We got a flag. Yeah. Interesting, man. WKU, they're 11-0 when leading after the third quarter.
Now that lead was 17 until the first 7 seconds.
Exactly.
And now hopping out of there, limping a little bit, is Price. Very valuable player after that scuffle for the football. And that's not good news for USF. Meantime, there's a WKU player on a knee at the 40-yard line. And we still have to settle a flag, which we think is an offsides.
Offside. Defense, number 9. Half the distance goal, retry.
Okay.
Yeah, he was before the snap almost. And wonderful Terry is needing a little assistance to get off the field for WKU, number 5. So we have disorder in the house, even on a PAT right now.
Yes, we do. All right, guys, let's try this again.
Much easier. Much calmer. 10-point game. The problem is, at the moment, if you're a Bulls fan, you say, hey, that's great, we scored, but we're having a very hard time stopping WKU right now, and that's going to be on the Bulls defense, which has looked like a tired bunch in the third quarter, but for the moment, celebration time in Tampa. Rodney Adams for the touchdown. Adams, excuse me, from Flowers to Adams. And now, can USF defense step up against a WKU offense that's on fire right now? This is Towner at the 5. They're waiting for him, and he won't even get to the 20.
No, he won't. Nope.
You know, on the touchdown throw, they just faked the bubble screen to Tyree McCants, number 8. He stepped up and stepped back, and then left one-on-one for Rodney Adams against wonderful Terry, number 5. He just simply ran a post route. But how about the throw from Quentin Flowers, a 53-yard strike? Beautiful throw and catch. Just a simple post route. I tell you what, Rodney Adams is having an afternoon. 5 for 120, one touchdown. He had 2 rushes, 2 for him.
Yep.
36 yards and a touchdown.
Dowdy facing some pressure, guns it out, caught by Nicholas Norris, who's got a couple of touchdowns, and he's going to lose 5 yards. So at USF defense, Colin McGee coming up with a stop there, 2nd and long coming up. Now WKU has scored on each of their last 4 possessions, all touchdowns.
Let's see if the Bulls defense can get something going right here. They haven't been able to stop Dowdy this whole second half.
Empty backfield set here. 3 right, 2 left. They try a stunt, and that pass missed. It'll be 3rd down and 14. Norris was the intended receiver there. Not calling Taywan Taylor's name very often.
Not at all. But Nicholas Norris has been doing some work today.
Yep.
Yeah.
Let's check in before the snap with Quint.
A screen defensively, you got to key in, defend the screen here. The louder this bull crowd gets it off behind the quarterback, the more likely it is that Brom's going to sense that and throw a screen.
5 to snap it, Quinn. He's got to hurry down to 4. 3 gets it in time. They draw play instead, which is kind of a running screen, and it won't be a first down, I don't think. They got 11, they needed 14. Augie Sanchez on the stop. But they do make it a little bit easier for someone who's been very quiet in this half, Jake Collins, the punter.
We haven't seen a lot of Jake. We may not see Jake right now.
Look at this. Are you kidding me?
Well, now they're going to run
him
on the field.
I thought so. But they're going to have to hurry on this punt. You got one player who's coming up, hasn't even put his helmet on yet. Fullwood's awaiting the punt back at the 35-yard line. You've got seven to snap it. You certainly don't want to take a delay here.
No, you don't.
Three, two, one, just in time. I mean, a half a second had to be left. Fullwood, that ball is playing him right now. And he'll get to about the 24 or 25-yard line. That was the best he could do. We're going to step aside, catch our breath, and find out, does USF have another punch in them? From the 25-yard line, Quentin Flowers, who's been hot. Both these quarterbacks have had moments when they haven't been at their best, but they've had many more when they have been.
Yeah, Quentin Flowers hit five of his last six throws for 91 yards and a touchdown.
And De'Ernest Johnson's going to run for a first down, it appears, before he is dragged down with some impunity by Leston. The safety made a lot of tackles today. That is a gain of 11 and a first down.
And Nick Holt, the defensive coordinator for the Hilltoppers, he's going with the one high safety. But I tell you, Leston's playing very, very far back now after those two long touchdown throws.
And Adams with another catch right in front of his teammates.
A lot of time left. No panic by either coordinator or either head coach who's calling the plays. Willie Taggart, USF's play caller and head coach, seems like he's content with just doing what they do.
First down and 10 after that catch by Adams.
Jet sweeps.
Yep, they're trying this again. Adams.
Yeah.
But it's three on this one. It'll be second down and 7. Awara, Prince Charles Awara, in there on the stop. You know, we were talking during the break. What's the approach going to be for USF? Ground and pound, which they're really good at with Marlon Mack, or are they going to get aggressive and throw it around a little bit? Right now, Mack's not in the game. Flowers, he's an excellent runner, being chased. Across the body throw, open is McCants. And McCants with a few moves to the 25, inside there, down to the 15, and inside there even to the 11-yard line, a 41-yard pickup.
Like I said, Willie Taggart's just dialing up the same plays that they did earlier. And you know the dangerous part of Quentin Flowers' games is he's so elusive. His improv game is on point. To throw that across his body while he's going to his right.
Look out here.
That's what makes him so dangerous.
Adams looked like he was going to throw it. He's going to instead run it and finally run out of bounds at around the 8-yard line. That appeared to me like this first thought was, I'm going to throw it.
And a heads-up play by Adams to just tuck it and run it, too, and get some positive yards. Because you're right. He wanted to throw that ball. It wasn't there down the field. He could have got tackled for a loss, but you know he's been playing so well tonight. He's always going to make the first guy miss.
Second down and 7. We just have so much time left in this game, 11-16 and counting. Adams is out of the ball game right now. He's got to be utterly exhausted, and he might be hurt. So that's a bit of a loss as USF loads up the left side with receivers. Flowers on the carry. Bouncing it to the outside. Got a big block. He'll walk in.
Wow.
Bronson made that play with the block.
That's what makes Quentin Flowers Quentin Flowers. He can get out of just about any situation because he's so slippery. A dynamic runner with the ball in his hands, very hard to tackle, extremely elusive. And then on top of all that, he has a speed that he's going to get to the corner. Look at, and Nick Holt's like, man, what more can we do? What a ball game we got, Dave.
Two rushing touchdowns for Flowers, almost in the exact same spot. 38-35, exactly 11 minutes remaining in our game. A USF, by the way, when they get 20 points more, they haven't lost a game this year. And they're still behind.
Six
plays, 75 yards, 209. Seriously, you're not turning this game off, are you? No, you're not. Maybe it's this place. I don't know. Last year's game, 103 points. Memphis beating BYU. We have 73 today. That's 176 points, and we haven't played two full games of the Miami Beach Bowl in 2 years. Towner from the 8. And he's going to run out of room across the U.S. to the USF sidelines. Well, Brandon Dowdy, the outstanding redshirt senior quarterback from Davie, Florida, just up the road from Miami. Got off to a slow start, Dez, but he's been brilliant ever since.
You know, it may have been the two-week layoff between this game and their last game. He had to knock off some rust, but I tell you what, once he hit his stride, this kid has been on fire. I mean, just spreading the ball all around, very comfortable, extremely accurate, what we expected and anticipated coming into this game. This game started off slow, not only for Western Kentucky, but for USF too, but now both play callers, you know, Western Kentucky's Jeff Brohm and USF's Willie Taggart, they're dialing up some plays that are just amazing. This is a very exciting game. What we anticipated coming into this game?
Dowdy, middle of the field. Nice little catch by Taylor. We have not mentioned Taywan Taylor, who came into the game with almost 1,400 yards in receiving this year, 17 touchdowns, and he gets a first down there.
I'll tell you what, Dave, Jeff Brohm, he dialed up some really good plays earlier in the first half, too, but the execution wasn't there.
No.
Now the offense, they're executing. So I think they went in at halftime and said, listen, guys, the plays are there. We just need to settle down and execute.
Taylor over 100 yards receiving in this game for the 8th time he's done that this season. Extra yards picked up by Anthony Wales after the catch, and he'll take it into Bulls territory for a WKU first down.
And I'm thinking he probably told them, listen, they're not stopping us. We've stopped ourselves in that first half. And Mason, they made some great halftime adjustments. That defensive line, the USF, they've been... We haven't heard from them this second half.
No, you're right.
At all.
They've been very quiet. Yep, that's an excellent. That's why Dowdy's been able to operate under control. He's not a scrambler. He's not a zone read guy. He's an old-fashioned pocket passer.
Right.
He'll go on the handoff here, though. Bullock will stop on Anthony Wales. And while they unpile here, let's check in with Quinn Kesmick.
He lives at the line. Jamie Bird is on the sideline right now with a left knee injury. Safety leads the team with 5 sacks, 3 interceptions. He's a huge playmaker out of their Husky position, and he's one of their key pass rushers. He is out right now, and that's impacting the amount of pressure that the South Florida Bulls can get on Dowdy.
Yeah, that's an excellent point, Quinn. Thank you very much. He plays that Husky, which is sort of the nickelback position that is almost mandatory now the way college football is played. Dowdy. And that ball's up for grabs and intercepted by USF, Eric Lee.
That ball bounced off of about 3 guys' hands, helmets, shoulder pass, before it was finally intercepted by Eric Lee. What a good job by the big fella just staying with the ball.
Almost a 300-pound senior.
Look at that.
Wales and Nichols, and everybody had some chances of that, and Lee, trailing the play, comes up with it.
And on that possession right there, USF went to their dime defense with just 3 down linemen. That might be the adjustment they're going to make now that Jamie Bird is out the game with a knee injury.
2 interceptions thrown by Dowdy. No turnovers by USF. Flowers escaping. That is turning something out of nothing.
Yes. He has another gear, too, because it just seems as though he was coasting. And they say, okay, I'm going to go ahead and run. I'm not going to throw. And no one can catch him. He's so dangerous. And Nick Holt, the defensive coordinator for Western Kentucky, said, that's why we need all eyes on Quentin Flowers.
If you tuned in to watch Monday Night Countdown, that is on ESPN2.
But enjoy this.
Oh, please do. We're not telling you to go to Monday Night Countdown. We're just saying that if you are a big fan of that great show,
right,
that's where you can find it.
I'm a huge fan of Monday Night Countdown, but this game right here is just off the charts. This is what we expected, though. It's turning to whichever team has the ball last will probably win one of those type of games.
Here has been a big issue against USF today. Poor play on third downs. They're 1 of 10. Flowers, pump fake. Receiver slipped at the 25-yard line. That was McCants. He was open. I don't know if that was Flowers' best throw either, but it missed. We have a USF player shaken up at the 44-yard line.
Oh, you got to see this. Wonderful Terry, number 5, just leveled Rodney Adams, number 87.
And that's who the player is down.
Yeah, he just leveled him on this play.
I was watching the football, so I missed the hit.
Yeah, I watched it. Number 5, Wonderful Terry, just teed off on him. Just, yeah, I saw the whole thing. I thought they were going to throw a flag on him.
Well, it's interesting because the pass was incompleted around the 25-yard line, and right, Adams is back at the 43,
yeah,
being tended to by the trainers.
Yeah.
So look at the very bottom right of your screens and take a look at it here. You know, there it is right there.
Yeah. He teed off on him. I saw that. I thought it was going to be a penalty just because.
Yeah.
He wasn't the intended receiver, but.
And there's no way that Adams is expecting that. He just turns his head and Terry just clobbered him.
Yeah, he did.
You see also what happened to the pattern. I'm not sure that's ever going to be a catch if the receiver stayed upright. So everybody kind of catching their breath a little bit in the stands. Great representation from the Hilltopper faithful and also from those from the Tampa area.
And with the game Adams has had so far, they can ill afford to lose him. He's had a monster game.
Six catches, 130 yards. Now it's 4th down and 6. And I don't see a punter. I don't see a punt formation. I see USF with a quarterback on the field. And there was certainly plenty of time for Willie Taggart to make a decision about what he wanted to do while Adams was being tended to. And this isn't a fake to draw him off sides either. Flowers in some trouble. He got loose. Flowers, first down, USF. He does it with his feet.
I mean, what more can you say about Quentin Flowers? And you know, he actually tried to hang in the pocket and tried to go through his progression, his first read, his second read, and nothing was there. Really good coverage down the field. Nick Hope came right through the A-gap and missed him. And once you miss a guy like Flowers, you know, he's going to at least get the first down, if that's not more.
So devastating about running quarterbacks. Now a lot of motion here, and that just didn't work. Nothing doing with Marlon Mack. Second down and long coming up. Clock at 7:11. Flowers has run for 90, by the way. And Quint, one of the things that you talked about, we talked with the coaches yesterday, and we talked about all three of us when we got here, is they're entering that soft part of the field.
You can see the sod that's over the infield here at Marlins Park. Coach Taggart, at halftime when I spoke to him, was really concerned. He said, we've had the opportunity to make plays. We just keep slipping.
Flowers directing traffic on the run. Finds his man right at the mark, McCants.
What a throw. What a throw on the move, too. I tell you what, you look at Western Kentucky's defense, the ends, they're going to have to just contain Flowers. He's able to break containment so easily. They need to start to rush up the field, make sure he cannot break contain and get around the corner.
Pump fake once, wants it all right there, takes the underneath. There's a flag down at the 24-yard line. That play gains virtually nothing. Let's see what the penalty is. I'm looks like this is going to go against USF for illegal motion.
Offense, number six. Penalties declined. Second down.
And 10. Well, if you're wondering about Emilio Nadelman, he's definitely on the fringe of his range right now at the 27. His long of the year, 49. He did miss one earlier today. Adams back in the game. And he's in the slot to the left of the quarterback, Flowers.
That's good to see Adams back there on the field in the game, because it'd be such a shame to lose him on a play like that.
Little lob, and it didn't work. Tried to fit it into Marlon Pope. Veteran tight end. He was open. That's a tough touch pass. Third down and 11. 1 of 11 on third downs, USF. Pope will check out. Is this two down territory? Is something that I'm sure Willie Taggart has already thought about as the play caller. He'd also better hurry and get the play in. He may be taking a timeout. Down to 5, to 4, to 3. Nope, they're going to run it. Flowers under a lot of pressure, but he's so hard to sack. Flags are down. Flowers toward the end zone, and it is high and incomplete, but is a penalty marker at the 30-yard line.
And that one's coming back. There's a holding.
Incomplete.
Holding
flags
is the call
down
against USF. Fourth and 11. Do you take the penalty?
I think you decline it.
Or do you back them up to where they're out of field goal range?
Holding.
Yeah, you know,
the way 10-yard penalty, third down.
Western Kentucky's defense has been playing, I would take the penalty and back them up.
Yep, and
back
that's
them
what they
out
did.
Of field goal range.
Yep, and they are now out of field goal range.
Yeah, exactly.
So
I would take it.
But every time we see somebody get a second chance in this game, they usually take it.
That is true.
And they convert all day.
There's a little strange pattern going on around here with that. You're right about that. That's a very good point. Let's see what the Bulls offense can do.
On third and 21. And here's the thing that'll break your heart or help you, depending on who you're rooting for, about Flowers, is he might scramble and pick up 15, and then you go for it on fourth down. He guns it, and it is picked off. No, incomplete. Incomplete is the ruling from the side judge. They're saying the ball that Prince Charles Owara thought he caught hit the ground. Bottom line, it's fourth down and 20. They're now 1 of 12 on third down, and I really didn't see a receiver anywhere near this football.
No,
let me take a look.
Yeah.
Yep, good call by the officials. It absolutely skipped.
Yeah, yep.
The strange Paul Newman, who's handling our numbers today, points out to me, Des, that USF has hit only one third down, and they've hit 2 fourth downs. And they're bringing out the kicker.
Oh, wow. All righty then.
Well, this will be a career long.
And Western Kentucky's confused with who should be on the field, who should not be on the field, so they had to call a timeout. Western Kentucky.
He got a practice kick.
Yes, he did. Did it go? I couldn't tell
you. No, I don't think it looked.
It looked like he.
I didn't see
it to the left.
Yeah, it looked like it was a little bit off, but now we got a little practice.
Yeah.
But that's.
You can make an adjustment now.
Now they're down to one timeout, Western Kentucky. He had the length on it. I'm not too sure. Now, Jeff Prohm is just spewing right now. He's really mad that his guys were not ready.
Exactly.
And I don't blame him.
There's no excuse for that.
You
no
might
excuse.
Need that timeout.
Yeah. No, you're right. I can see the confusion on the sideline. He had a guy halfway out there.
Yep.
Doing that, should I go, should I not go dance?
Yeah, they were in danger of getting an illegal substitution or too many men on the field penalty.
Exactly.
And bringing the kicker closer.
Yep. Yep.
You, this is a hard enough kick as it is. Hey, yeah, Quint, tell us a little bit more about Emilio.
Well, you know, he hit nine straight at one point this season after a woeful kick against East Carolina. He missed a 23-yarder. Little technique change. He brought his plant foot closer to the ball, and that got him on that hot streak. Now, he's missed one today. The wind right now, I'm under the goalpost. It is a very tricky wind at his back right now, but it changes every 5 seconds. A good time for him to kick would be right now because there's a decent wind at his back.
And no, wide left.
Alrighty then.
5:58 to go. Western Kentucky hangs on, and it wasn't by much. We do have a fun finish, and we do hope you stay with us. And away we go. And so Western Kentucky, their last two possessions, a punt and an interception. They've only run six plays in this quarter. Dowdy trying to get set, guns it across the middle. The catch is made by Grant. And he takes a shot, but not until he gets into Bulls territory. A 19-yard pickup on a first down for the Hilltoppers.
That was just a really good job of Antoine Grant just staying alive on the play, because that flea flicker was supposed to be a deep pass. He lined up way over to the left side, saw that Dowdy was in trouble, cut his route, and came across the middle of the field. Really heads-up play by Grant.
Reminder that NFL Countdown is airing right now on ESPN2, brought to you by Applebee's, and we want you to stay here, but we understand if you want to sneak over and see what they're up to. Now they go to the ground. This is Anthony Wales. Wales breaks three. Down to the 10. 5. He scores.
You know, I wonder if they were going to keep it on the ground, because at this point, they've averaged 3.3 yards per carry. Well, they're going to just keep it on the ground, try to chew up the clock. They kept it on the ground and got a big run for a touchdown.
Yeah, that 3-3 is going to go up a little bit. We now are over 1,100 total yards in this game. 592 for WKU and 513 for the Bulls.
What a great job by the lineman, too. Pulling out there on the right-hand side. The center, Max Halpin, did a really good job sealing it for Anthony Wales.
And they're taking a further review generated by the booth as to make sure that's a touchdown or not. It looked at first glance like it was, like this call will hold up. But the replay official, Rick Jackson, talking to the referee, Greg Blum, right now, a Mid-American Conference officiating crew here. Now we'll take some similar looks as well. Again, everybody, I think everybody around the country is joining hands and saying the words indisputable video evidence at the same time, because we all know the phrase by now over these years.
Yes.
And it seems, this is the ultimate look right here. That's a touchdown, boys and girls, in every language you can speak.
Exactly.
So we've had six scoring plays of 34 yards or more. This is going to be one of them. I don't see how they're going to be able to well, I shouldn't say that, because I've been proven wrong before. But the evidence appears to favor a touchdown.
I think you're safe on this one, buddy.
Say it, then I won't get in trouble from the boss if you say it.
No, that's a touchdown. That is a touchdown. They caught USF in the blitz, too. And Augie Sanchez missed that tackle.
Wait a minute. Is his foot out of bounds? It's the two. Is his foot OB there? Because if it is, we're wrong.
Right.
After review, the ruling of a touchdown stands.
Okay. Hey, buddy, you got it right. All right.
No email for me.
There we go. Yes, sir. That last shot you showed, that last angle, you had me sweating bullets over there.
I got a little nervous,
Wait, maybe.
Again, that incontrovertible, perfect video evidence just not available.
No. Nope.
So we wondered how WKU would respond. It didn't take long for us to find out.
Not at all.
Less than a minute.
That's the second time we had to review one of Wells' touchdowns today.
He needs to stay upright.
You know, come on.
So you got to think for a moment about a little bit of deflation on the USF sideline. South Florida comes roaring back. They got all their fans here buzzing. And now all of their defense, within not even a minute, gives up a long touchdown run. Yeah. Can they come back again?
Wow. Puts a lot of pressure on that offense. A lot of pressure on the offense. Still a two-score game. They're going to try to get in zone quick.
It's a 49-second drive, 64 yards in two plays. 79 points, 1,100-plus yards.
And a run at that.
Isn't that crazy?
A run. Wow.
Well, Wales over 1,000 yards this year, a redshirt junior from Louisville. Nine touchdown runs on the year. Yeah. It's your turn, Bulls. Ernest Johnson, Tyler McCants. USF was confident in their special teams coming into the game. They haven't busted one yet. Johnson can do it, though. Decent field position for the sophomore, Quentin Flowers. And a little pushing and shoving afterwards, but nothing. Nothing along the lines of last year's game, that's for sure. Now for tonight's Capital One player of the game. There he is. The redshirt senior playing his final college game, Brandon Dowdy. 4.57, three TDs, two picks. Scouts are here to see him from the league. Been projected as perhaps a fourth round pick. And he isn't a zone read guy. He has that NFL profile. So hope it works out for him.
Yeah, me too.
Oh, Adams just plain dropped the football at the 30-yard line. That's a shocker. That was right. That almost was like a handoff. So yeah. Second down and 10.
Yeah, very uncharacteristic of Adams tonight to drop a ball like that. He's made some tough catches. Looks like he's a little fatigued when you just look at his body
language. Remember that hit he took, too?
Yeah, I think he's... Is he going out the game?
Yes, he is.
Yeah, he's going out the game. He's not right. He's not himself right now.
I think you're right. He took a vicious hit.
Yep.
And he's being tended to right now by the trainers. Meantime, Flowers going to take it deep down the field into double coverage, and it's broken up. Trying to get it to A.J. Legree. And there were two WKU defenders in there. Third down and 10 coming up.
Yeah, I think Flowers just tried to press a little bit on that one because you got two defenders right there. You got Ward.
I think that's Prince Charles.
And Prince Charles. Yeah, he's just trying to press. He's trying to do too much. There's still some time, man. Just move the ball down the field. Take what the defense gives you. Don't try to press because that could have easily been an interception.
For such a high-scoring game, it's amazing how poor these teams have been on third down. We've only had five converted the whole game. Flowers, he can convert it with his legs, though, and it's not going to happen. Excellent coverage that time by WKU's defense. Omarius Bryant just said, that's enough of that. Fourth down, clock running, 4:40, and now 4:30 to go. What do you do? You go for it?
I think you have to. Two-score game.
They've already had, WKU go for it at about their own 25-yard line.
Yeah, fourth and eight. I don't know if you have enough confidence in the defense to stop WKU.
Well, that's the good point.
The thing about when you watch USF's offense, like, all the routes so far have been, like, deep routes. No really intermediate or medium routes. A lot of deep routes or either bubble screens. So fourth and eight.
Nope, here we go.
Outside of Flowers scrambling, what will they actually dial up?
They've converted more fourth downs than third downs today. Flowers from behind. He's in some trouble on the run. Did he make the catch?
Yes, sir.
Dylan, that's a first down. What a throw.
Flowers is really, really accurate. Rolling out to his right. Hitting guys right there on the sideline with no more real estate left.
They may have to review that and make sure his feet were in bounds.
I couldn't tell from a second glance. That was a Deshaun Watson-style play right there.
Oh, without a doubt.
We've both seen a lot of him.
Exactly.
That's the kind of play Deshaun Watson at Clemson makes right there.
Throws it right over the defender, drops it in the bucket. I think his feet were in bounds. I think they were.
Well, we're getting another review, and very understandable. Now, after all of this, you're going to want to see the trophy ceremony. ESPN3 will be the place, and it'll be presented by Capital One immediately following our game.
Look at that throw, just right over to the defender's outstretched hands. Beat another defender.
Only
right
one
there, right between the numbers. That's an impressive throw by Flowers.
And a nice catch. You're talking about a guy who's only had 7 catches coming into the game, Elkanah Dillon. I believe Sean Price has been nicked up and has not come back after being hurt earlier.
Yeah, you're right about that.
So Dillon and Marlon Pope have been sharing the tight end job for South Florida. The ruling on the field is a completed pass. This might be our best look.
That's the best look. It's a completion.
Well, I'm looking at the officials, and nobody's writing anything down. So the telltale pad has not come out of anybody's back pocket. And here comes the call.
Review. The ruling of a completed catch is confirmed. First down.
Yes, sir.
Wow. Put the rubber stamp on that.
Yes, sir.
That's the first time we've heard confirmed all day from our crew. So yeah. They know.
Really, really good throw. I tell you, man, this Flowers on fourth down, man, he's hot.
And you're seeing Jeff Fromm acting as the get-back coach in addition as the head coach. Under 4 minutes.
That's the role of a strength and conditioning coach. Where is that guy at?
He's dealing with Nick Holt exclusively. Flowers. And he just wisely realized, I don't think he could even see as Bryant was all over him.
Right. No, you're right about that. Good decision by Flowers just to chuck it out of bounds. There was nothing there.
And again, we invite you to the postgame trophy ceremony presented by Capital One following our game, whenever that ends.
Well, I tell you what, that Nick Holt, he is so intense.
He came into the meeting room and sits in the chair, and the chair could rock a little bit, and he got that thing going, and I wasn't sure that chair was going to make it.
Yeah, I don't think it was designed to rock like that. I just don't think so.
Yeah, it was your standard office chair.
Yeah.
This is Johnson on the carry, and he's shoved out of bounds after pickup of 5, third down and 5. But those are the coaches you love, and those are the coaches you remember if you're a player.
Exactly.
I'm sure every guy on that defense has Nick Holt stories, and especially his son, who happens to be the leader on the field. Number 10 is a terrific linebacker for this team. First team All-Conference USA. Flowers, middle of the field. We're going to get a flag? No, we are not. Interference not called. It'll be another fourth down coming up and 4 as Prince Charles Awara defending A.J. Legree.
I thought that Prince Charles Awara got to the receiver before the ball did. I was surprised we didn't see any yellow laundry on the field after that play. That looked like it was a P.I.
It was, and it just wasn't
definitely
called.
Definitely a P.I.
Yeah, it was. All right, here we go again on fourth down. USF hasn't missed on fourth down today. Flowers, he misses there.
Misses badly, too.
Shocked at how inaccurate that pass was. Now, he got cuffed around a little bit. I thought he might just take off.
Yeah.
Because he's so devastating as a runner. But Western Kentucky is now in a position to lock down this game.
Yeah, I thought he was going to tuck it and run, too. I mean, he has a lane right there. He just, he overthrew that ball.
Yeah.
Wow.
Not even close.
No, sir.
So Monday Night Countdown airing on ESPN2, served by Applebee's. And when we sign off here, following our game, you can pick it up on ESPN. And, of course, the Monday Night game tonight, Detroit and New Orleans.
Go Lions.
There'll be some hash slung in that game, too, with those two quarterbacks.
Oh, yeah.
So WKU comes out, and they throw the football. Antoine Grant making a grab for a four-yard gain. And a timeout taken by USF. They have one remaining. Stopping the clock with 2:56 to go.
What an entertaining game.
What? Thought it would be, and when we started slowly, we were both kind of puzzled.
Yeah, exactly. Like, the defenses took over in the first quarter and a half, and then Dowdy kind of caught fire late in the second quarter, and in that third quarter, everything just exploded.
Yeah, yeah, it got crazy.
Yes.
28 points in that quarter for Western Kentucky. They were down 14-0 at one point in this game.
Yep.
And then they took a big lead, and South Florida came roaring back and got it from 38-21 to 38-35. And now you see where we are here, 45-35, with just under 3 minutes remaining in the game. Dowdy, 461 yards passing.
Dowdy as good as advertised, I tell you that. Man, the way he bounced back, too, from that horrible start shows you the character and resilience of this kid.
Yeah, that
you
really know? Matters, and I think the pros will notice that as much as they will notice the 461 yards. DeAndre Furby comes in, the bruising at tailback, number 32, on the Conference USA all-freshman team.
Man, he's just a baby. All-freshman team, just a baby.
Yeah. Doesn't hit like one.
There he is, too. Look at him.
Wow. Oh, he took lowered shoulders.
Took that guy for a ride. Yes.
That'll be a first down. He needed six. Looks like he got seven. Well, let's show everybody who might just be tuning in to catch NFL Countdown, somebody who may be in the NFL one day, Brandon Dowdy.
This Brandon Dowdy started off slow, but man, I tell you, once he got into his rhythm, was able to find Nicholas Norris twice of two just great plays. Not a defender within 15 yards of Norris on that play. And he's just doing a really good job of reading the defense, picking them apart with his accuracy. Reminds me of like a typical West Coast offense of a West Coast quarterback. Mm-hmm. Get the ball out of his hands quick, very smart.
Little run blitz here and a very unhappy DeAndre Furby, but they put pressure from the edges. He's going to lose a yard.
But that's the way you got to get Furby. You got to get him before he gets going.
Gets you. Right.
Yeah.
Get him before he gets you.
Yeah, because, man, when he gets headed downhill, he's going to run somebody over.
Well, that was a dynamic run. When they on that second down play, when they needed the extra yards, 601 yards now for Western Kentucky, based on our numbers.
Dowdy told me the other day that he's going to, you know, pack his stuff up, come back down here and work out, get ready for the combine.
Yep. Good for him. I hope he gets a shot. I'm sure he'll get a shot, and I hope he succeeds.
Yeah, I'm sure he will.
By all accounts, a really likable young man.
Yep.
Very much respected by his teammates. We have flags down here. That'll stop the clock with a minute and 27 seconds remaining. In 1973 was the last time Western Kentucky won 12 games. They were not a Division I program. There was no such thing as FBS or any of that other stuff.
Holding. Wow. 1973.
Yep. Be a holding call.
Holding. Offense, number three. The penalties decline. Result of play, third down.
Got to keep those downs moving.
Third and final. Timeout. South Florida. This will be a 30-second timeout.
So with 1:27 to go, they'll step aside for make their last adjustment on defense they can make. Tom Allen came over from Ole Miss in his first year. Part of this unit that turned things around. It was really weird. Willie Taggart told us it was a loss to Memphis that he thought was the turning point in the season because the players really began to grasp what they could have done.
He saw the emotional reaction to them losing that game and said he went home and told his wife, you know what, we're going to be okay.
Yeah.
Because he felt as though they showed that that loss really, really hurt them deep and meant something to them. And he said the next day when they ended up practicing 2 days later, no balls were on the ground, guys were out there really laser focused, and he knew that the team was going to be okay. So you're right. It's interesting sometimes the effect that a loss can have on a team. Well, and we'll see what effect this one will have on.
you look at who's coming back. You know, Quentin Flowers and Marlon Mack going to be back. They're both sophomores. They've got some young receivers coming back. Adams is a junior, so he should be back unless he tries to go pro. And he may, we have a flag down here, and he may want to investigate that possibility.
And they got some transfers, too, waiting in the wings.
88% of the roster from
Offense,
Florida.
Offense, number two, five-yard penalty, third down.
This is not a clean finish for Jeff Brohm's team with back-to-back penalties when they're trying to put this game away.
Right. You can't be happy about this.
We started in the sunshine. We end this game in the moonshine and a beautiful, warm, sunny South Florida day.
That's not a double entendre, is it, my friend?
Not really.
That was pretty clever, though.
Yeah, thank you.
It's accurate, too. Very accurate.
You know, just because you hang around with wordsmiths like Reese doesn't mean every once in a while we lower-tier guys can't get a good one off.
Oh, calm down now.
Furby headed left. And they'll get around to the 46-yard line. Eric Lee brings him down. But USF cannot stop the clock. It is fourth down.
So, are we going to see the...
And for Western Kentucky, what a magical season. You win the conference.
Yep.
You don't lose in the conference. You come from behind against a good USM team. You come here, you fall behind, and you show that same bounce-back ability that you did to win your conference. This has been a remarkable year. Jeff Brohm is going to be 20-7 as the head coach in just two seasons. Yeah, we'll have a delay of game penalty here. Well, I'm reading Jeff Brohm's lips. He's going, just punt it. Right. Just punt it. Just kick it down there. Like, I wonder if the punter said, Coach, what do you want me to do? What do you think?
Fake it.
What is that thing you're doing game day? You had one job to do.
Just kick one it. Job.
Speaking of which, when do you take off for all of your national championship prep and all that? When do you go?
Oh, man. I have to. I'll have the Orange Bowl, so that'll be fun. That's another home game for me. And then
beautiful.
We got the Rose Bowl. And then for the national championship game, I'm not 100% sure yet. And then he shanks it.
Well, he was scared to death.
Bro, I'm like, can you believe this? Really?
He was scared to death.
Hey, look at it. What is it? 34 seconds left. He's still out there coaching.
Yeah.
Still out there coaching. I feel you, Coach. That's how it should be. Come on.
No, you can't.
Come on.
Your players are watching your every move.
Yeah. No, come on.
You know, they take their cues from the head coach as much as they do from anybody else, of course.
Exactly. Other coaches are back there kind of smiling.
You know what's going to cool him off? His Gatorade bath will cool him off.
Yes, sir.
That's what he's about to get, barring a miracle.
Yeah. He's got the cops surrounding him now. Yeah, this one's in the books.
Yeah, the police are going to get, the highway patrolmen there are going to get wet. Over 300 yards, or pretty close to 300 yards for Quentin Flowers tonight, total offense. Three touchdowns responsible for, but it's just not going to be enough. Oh, that's a good throw, and
really
a catch by
throw.
Dylan.
Really good throw.
So we got 10 seconds to go. This is going to be the occasion where we didn't lose. The clock ran out on us.
We need to see Nick. There's Nick. Look at Nick.
Oh, no, he's not done yet. No way, baby. This will be the final play of the game, barring a defensive foul.
Mm-hmm.
Flowers underneath, out of bounds, and that does it.
There's
the Miami Beach Bowl goes to Western Kentucky. They go 2-0 over the last 2 years in bowl games in exotic locations. You got to find a cold weather place to take a shot at this team because they win in the Bahamas and they win in Miami.
Exactly.
What a ball game this turned out to be. 612 total yards for Western Kentucky. 461 from Dowdy. Norris five catches for 120 and Wales ran for 105. What a ball game this one was. Take a moment to thank John Sullivan, our booth official, our crew here in South Florida and around the country. Paul Newman.